If you guys do what I say,
they were cutting in and out.
I think you're going to be good to go if you just kind of reboot everything and you start fresh. I think you're going to be...
Winter's Lair, though, is a pretty loyal dude. He said he refreshed ECLA. We still got two new guys saying lag.
Lagging like what? Like the video? Like the video is lagging? Like what's lagging? Are we just behind a little bit with the audio?
This computer is lagging itself, and that's what we're
Did you fuck up this computer too?
No, it's been fucking working fine. Skype though, look at it. I closed it out a second ago, it still hasn't even moved.
Well, anyways, well, John Morgan, loyal diehard, he says, I refreshed and it seems fine. Maybe it's just the computer. I don't think it's us. Maybe it's Justin TV, or not Justin TV, Ustream, who we use, right?
Could be
them every Tuesday night. They seem to...
What do they mean by a lag? What the hell does that mean?
Yeah, let us know with a lag.
No, what is a lag? Like, obviously there's a delay.
Like, are they far behind, or...
Well, how would they even know? Because how do they know... You know what I mean? How do they know where we're talking and when it goes? Like, I don't know what a lag means. Oh, like skipping?
Yeah.
Kind of laggy, skipping, buffering kind of thing.
Are we just a little bit far behind tonight? Which, you know, there might be more of a delay than normal, like a 30-second delay.
Just turn Skype off, and it looks like the computer's running way fucking better right now.
Yeah.
So maybe that was it.
Maybe. Why does Skype always fuck us up?
I don't know.
Let's try now. Anyways, all right. Here's what we'll do. We'll give it 5 more minutes, we'll get the plugs out of the way, we'll get into it, because we really got to talk about, not necessarily Monday Night Raw from last night, dude, but the CM Punk podcast that came out on Thanksgiving. Good Lord, how awesome was that? And then, Vince McMahon, well, it's got to catch up.
My question is just video issues, or is it audio as well? Like, when it's skipping and lagging and shit, is it only the video, or is it the audio? Because if the audio is fine, I would suggest just minimizing your browser. You don't need to look at us. And you could just do a show and they could hear it, you know. Now they say we're off the air. But didn't this go through?
It's got to be Ustream, bro. It's got to be Ustream. It's not us. Because we can see, we've got our production computer up here and everything
it
is A-OK.
It disconnected once, but that's when you purposely
did it. That's when I purposely did it. But yeah, everything should be. So it's got to be Justin or Ustream. It's got to be Ustream.
I didn't get the caller thing we had before the show either. Something's up. And it could be all right.
It's not all right.
It could be. Why couldn't we get callers to come through?
Because it wouldn't be cutting in and out on people. See that it's cutting in and out on people.
True.
We would see that right up there, and when we know we
video
we
streams, and it pauses, loops back by about 10 seconds. Now
that's Ustream.
One guy says if you refresh the page, then it's all right. So we're getting mixed answers. I don't know what the fuck to do here.
What do we do?
Oh, God, there's so much stuff to talk about, too. I wanted to get into it. We're wasting time.
Seems all right now. I think we're good. Maybe it's a mix of Skype and
Let me tell you this. Guaranteed, the archive is recording, and we can see that what we're recording right now is perfect.
Absolutely.
So no matter what, if it's fucking up for you right now and you can't hang with us,
right.
Go ahead and bail, but make sure to check out facebook.com/Ryan Clark. That wasn't a lag. That was us. facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR. We'll put the archive up, and then you should be able to watch the show start to finish with no lag.
Bam! Look, there's three different people that
Let's
says
ignore
it,
and let's just
better.
Do the show like
So here we go. Are you ready? So, last Thursday.
Hey, welcome to WZR.
By the way, welcome to WZR TV Tuesdays.
From you guys on Reddit, we watched SmackDown spoilers live.
Yes.
Momentarily, we're waiting on getting some notes from our correspondent in the building.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We do have one tonight, by the way. So here's the deal. Last Thursday, interesting timing. It was Thanksgiving. Everybody says it's better now, by the way.
I don't even want to look at it.
So last Thursday, Thanksgiving, right? Kind of a crazy day, right, for this to break. Colt Cabana, who does a podcast.
I know,
pretty
I broke
much
it.
Once a week. Why did it break on Thanksgiving, on Thursday, on that Thursday, in Thanksgiving?
I forget the other part. I know the first part. It broke. Word spread out that he had recorded this thing with Colt Cabana.
Okay.
So once that word spread out, I think they decided to put it up before WWE preemptively did this, or they wanted to get it out before something, because the word got out that he did it.
Right.
So that was the reason they had to, unfortunately, run on Thanksgiving. But I can tell you right now, Thanksgiving or not, I sat flat on my ass and listen for 2 hours to CM Punk talk about his career.
I listened twice.
Me too.
I listened twice.
The same day twice?
No, following day.
Me neither. I listened to it on Thanksgiving, and then again 2 days after.
Right.
Yeah. And I started the rewatch last night's Vince Austin thing, but I only got about 20 minutes into it to work, got busy. But that was just as fucking good, but for very different reasons.
The Vince Austin thing.
And real quick, we've still got another Punk Cabana podcast with the Q&A.
We do.
Coming this week. And Austin said on Twitter, quote unquote, one more round, so there'll be additional shit that they filmed after the stream cut off last night on the network that they're going to put on podcast one.
You and I talked about it. That's what people. Everybody says we're fine, by the way. I know you don't want
to. I don't want to think about it.
But, that's what people want to see. Everybody's talking about original content.
I wrote a column today, scscoops.com, called Now That, in all capital letters, is how you get WWE Network subscriptions.
Absolutely.
Last night's thing, and they bitch about, oh, but God, production costs, guys. It costs so much money to roll this footage out and edit this and do that.
Right.
That was two guys. Exactly what we're doing right now. Two guys, a microphone, a camera, a desk. And just
that's it.
Conversation. That cannot be that fucking expensive.
Right.
You know what I mean? We do it for free.
Right.
Other than internet costs and some stuff we had to buy and this and that. But once you pay for that shit, any show we do is free after the fact because you don't have to keep buying new microphones and stuff, you know, unless they break.
Right.
So there's no excuse why they can't do shit like they did last night.
Absolutely.
Or even the ECW Exposed thing with Heyman and Styles. Same thing. Two guys, camera, lights, and people talking. Why don't they do more of that? It's clearly stuff that the people love.
I think when they see the numbers that come out from last night's
and
podcast,
the feedback.
And the feedback, and it's all positive that comes out, I think they are going to need to do something. And my suggestion to you was earlier today, I had said to you that, okay, Austin did it with Vince McMahon.
Yeah, I love this idea, by the way. I still want to use it in my column. Too.
Next up has got to be Triple H, and after that, Steph.
It's got and they could even go into like Michael Hayes, Pat Patterson.
Creative writers, people like that.
People you know, though, like Michael Hayes, Pat Patterson, maybe Bruce Richards not there anymore, but people like that. Maybe even bring Vince Russo back, talk about the Attitude Era, shit like that.
Who have been there for years
and that were part of the process of creating what we saw those years.
Exactly. Yeah. And what came
about? My only concern, I'm sorry to keep interrupting you.
I'm just happy that everything is. And by the way, one thing, real quick. If you guys, if it's still skipping for you, do a reboot one more time, and I promise you,
you
guys just need to catch up a little bit, but do one more reboot, and everything will be good to go. I know we're a little bit behind, like 30 seconds, maybe a minute for some of you guys, but
either way, we got a recorded show that'll be up tomorrow, early in the afternoon. Where was I going with that?
Well, I had said Triple H should be next, Stephanie McMahon should be after that.
Oh, you were talking about something else.
It's not that much as far as production costs. And then we got into Michael Hayes and people like that who have been there and been a part of the creative process.
My only thing is they're banking on, go ahead and correct that.
Okay.
They're banking on the Attitude Era stuff so much. There's only so many ways you can tell and retell what happened during the Attitude Era. They've got that running series, the Monday Night War documentary. They've done like 15 episodes of.
Is that good, by the way?
It's amazing. You watched one of them, the Austin one.
I did.
Yeah, so there's one on Austin. Just for example, one on Austin. Like, it's a view of the Attitude Era and the Monday Night War, WWE versus WCW, Raw versus Nitro, and they'll do it from the perspective of Austin's focus of it, The Rock's part in it. The Divas part in it,
Austin
McMahon, the NWO, celebrities. So they're trying every different way to find a different way to retell the same fucking story. And you hear a lot of the same shit in each of the shows because they're just telling the same story. It's about the Monday Night War.
Right.
So my point to this long-winded, rambling, babbling, incoherent nonsense is eventually they're going to run out of ways to capitalize on talking about the Monday Night Wars and the Attitude Era.
Right.
So they need shit that's going on now, or recent shit that they can talk. You know what
but
I mean?
You can start with the Attitude Era and then give a fuck about this era. I mean, Austin brought up a great thing with McMahon last night, where McMahon flat out said, "Your generation, the people these days, they're not as
the millennials,
right? Yeah. Right?
2000 and all.
they don't seem as into it, and they need to really step up.
He said they're not as motivated or ambitious.
They're not as motivated or as ambitious.
Grab the breath.
And then his comments about Cesaro, where he came out and flat out said, you know what, here, check it out.
Yes.
Let's do them one at a time.
Okay.
CM Punk from last Thursday
that was
and
first.
Then McMahon Hall.
Okay.
So, let's... I'll get the plugs out of the way.
Yes, quickly.
Monday Night Raw from last night. Yeah.
Well, there's not a fucking thing worth talking about on Raw.
There's really not.
Literally not.
Right? There's, I mean...
I can give a shit about anything that happened on that show last night.
It really wasn't. They had a 35-minute main event.
Yeah, which, and they had a 33-minute opener with no
Three-minute opener.
But then they went to commercial, came back, and it was still some other shit before they actually got started.
Yeah,
so it was literally 33 minutes until ding, 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 wrestling.
I had to write 1,200 words of my Raw play about
the opening segment alone, 1,200 words.
You were a beast.
Most weeks, I can do it. I'm getting, more and more. Somehow, I'm getting more and more detailed each week. Because now, the show, when I'm done, is about 5,000 to 6,000 words long.
Yeah.
Which is fucking insane. 3 hours straight type and 5,000 to 6,000 words.
Crazy.
Try it sometime.
Pay-per-views, too?
But it used to be about 3,000 for the whole show.
Right.
3 hours. Last night, I did basically half of a whole show of what it used to be in the first segment.
That's why you've got some of the best Raw play-by-play on the internet. Hell, the reports that I put up on Pro Wrestling Scoops and WZR Online are from Matt Boone.
Yes.
There are his reports that he cuts up on Raw. And the pay-per-views as well. So, all right, so here's the deal. Let me get the plugs out of the way. We'll go back to last Thursday. Hopefully you guys had a great Thanksgiving.
Yes.
As well.
Happy holidays.
Spend some time with your families. Eat some good turkey, some good eating, sweet potatoes, some mashed potatoes.
Sweet potatoes. We had some leftovers that the other day.
Did you?
Yeah.
We cooked a big 20-pound turkey here, man. We had the sweet potatoes. We
it's
had the
funny,
mashed
too,
because
I know, you know, you go on record with this. I'm the pickiest eater.
I know.
On planet Earth.
I know.
Everybody I know thinks sweet potatoes are gross as fuck. I love them. I love them. I don't like the marshmallow shit some people do, but I love sweet potatoes. The brown sugar and the sweet wine.
Yuck. But anyways. But we had a
I like cheesy potatoes, which are waiting for me right now.
They are waiting after we go out. And hamburgers.
Steak.
Cheeseburgers and...
I make mine like steak. I cut it up. Steak sauce. I make them real spicy.
Who cuts up all his hamburgers?
Yeah.
You know when you have a
hamburger? You have to cook
he
them
cuts it up
way,
like mommy did back in the day.
Because I dip each bite into a steak
barbecue sauce.
Steak sauce.
Or steak sauce.
Chicken nuggets is barbecue sauce. But even when you cook them, I'm an annoying pain in the ass because you got to cook mine different than everybody else. They've literally got one pan for the entire house.
And then
Ryan, his sister, his niece, his nephew, and then there's a separate pan for me because I have all these spices and seasonings.
He's got, what do you got? What do you got? Worcestershire?
Worcestershire sauce, teriyaki.
Teriyaki.
And then usually season all, and pepper.
And it's all got to be in one pan because nobody else.
And a lot of it.
Who the fuck takes their hamburgers and puts them in steak sauce and teriyaki?
Yeah.
Mix in seasonings and all this other. It's like, bleh.
I learned that from my mama.
And then a round hamburger, he cuts it up with a fork and a knife, and then you dip each piece into the steak sauce.
There's actually pictures of how
what
it looks like.
Why do you need
like
to dip it into, you're already cooking it with
steak sauce. I don't cook it with
steak
sauce.
No, you don't.
No, I cook it with Worcestershire, teriyaki, seasoning, pepper.
And then the steak sauce.
So it's a nice, spicy piece of meat.
Okay.
And then I cut it up and dip it into the spicy steak sauce to make it even worse.
Right.
And then I shit like a fucking truck driver the next day.
Okay.
If you need to know that part.
All right. So anyway. We'll skip Monday Night Raw, because that was about it. I mean, there was the opening segment.
It was a cool Heyman promo. There was a decent Wyatt Ambrose
Cena
thing.
Was kind of corny Cena last night, man. You know, sometimes...
What really bothered me about how shitty that show was and the fact that they did nothing. Like, they built it Cyber Monday, and the only thing that people could vote on was who AJ Lee's partner was. That was the only Cyber part about it.
No, you're right.
And then the anonymous GM appeared once at the beginning of the show, and then one other time, that was it. Meanwhile, if they wanted to do it, because like next week they're doing Seth Green.
Right.
Previous week was, what, Grumpy Cat, whoever the fuck. Wyatt, Stone Cold Steve Austin is in the building, ladies and gentlemen. He is sitting in the building. Why the fuck wouldn't you wait till next week to start your anonymous shit and have Austin general or co-host the show this week?
My idea with Austin is, like you said, he was in the building, so I had said in the final segment. And I thought they were going to do it because they started the main event at 10:30 Eastern time.
Yeah.
Okay? So I figured, okay, the main event is going to end at 10:55 or 11 o'clock, somewhere around there, right? They're going to go to a commercial break. They're going to come back. The glass is going to break. Steve Austin's going to come
in the ring.
Hear me out.
You know they're going to do the interview in the ring.
So I said,
20,000 feet.
If not that, maybe not in the ring. But I thought that we were going to hear the glass break. Wall was going to go off the air, and the glass was going to break.
You were
going
to hear what?
And Michael Cole, I was going to hear the glass break.
And then I'm thinking, all right, you're going to hear Michael Cole, Jerry Lawler, and JBL on commentary saying, Raw's going off the air right now. You've got to go to the WWE Network.
Ladies and gentlemen, Austin McMahon live in just seconds. Tune into the network. Yeah,
That would have been a way. You've got 3 million people watching Raw or whatever it is. 2.8.
Rating the delay because of the holidays. Yeah, but SmackDown had the highest viewership in fucking like the whole year.
It was like a 2.1.
So, yeah.
But
that was the day after Thanksgiving.
They have on Black Friday.
Black Friday. But people are out shopping, not watching TV.
Right. But I thought the way to do it was to go off the air and plug to your 3-4 million people that are watching Raw.
I did.
Hey, you got to sign up to the WWE Network. Yeah. Austin is live. He's here right now. And, of course, a lot of people that don't have the network would be pissed off. Like, what the fuck? Austin just came out. But That's your fault. That's the whole point.
You're on the network.
You've got to order the WWE Network to see. And then how many sign-ups do you think they would have got based off that? And I'm sure they got a bunch last night anyways with Michael Cole and the plugs.
I'm not sure because a lot of it, you know, people think a lot of it's kids, like a large chunk of it. But so eliminate them because, A, they don't have a credit card. If they're not signed up already, they're not sitting there at 11:07 on a school night saying, let me use my credit card and sign up for the, you know, there's plenty, and we found out through recent statistics that just came out like a week or two ago.
That the top demographic
It skews way older than people think.
Right.
So a lot of those guys could absolutely, if they don't have already, you know, break out the credit card and you know, sign up.
I thought that would have been the best way to do it, and then plug the podcast.
Exactly what you said. Glass break. My thing I said to you was they would, just like us sitting here right now, the set that Austin McMahon were on, they would have them fucking putting the mics on, and you see them sitting there, and they're adjusting their
papers. Getting ready.
Some lady we don't know is putting the mic on Austin, and ladies and gentlemen, coming up in just seconds.
On the WWE. Raw would go off the air with that.
I fully expect that. They didn't do it.
Yeah. I mean, they had Vince McMahon.
They did do a shot of him there sitting there, right?
They had Vince McMahon earlier in the night, right? Vince McMahon arrived in a limo earlier in the night and then, you know, spoke with Renee. Yeah. How good was Vince McMahon?
He was in rare form.
Right.
I'm really excited!
And then later in the night, they showed Austin, who was just sitting there, ready.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, I missed that.
Now, on the set that they had last night for the podcast.
They had both of them, no, it was just Austin.
No, it was just on Raw last night?
Yeah.
It was just Austin, and it came in the third and final hour. It was just Austin sitting there, you know, like I'm ready to do a podcast, just waiting on Vince McMahon.
Pretty much what I said. Showing him sitting there, getting prepared, waiting and getting ready.
Right, exactly. So, we had that.
Oh, wait, now I remember writing it now. Yeah. I was drunk as fuck during Raw.
All right, so... And that's about it. I mean, other than that, John Cena was corny during his promo on Raw.
Super douche mode,
And then they set up the tag team. They had like a tag team turmoil type match. They had last night. They set up two different feuds. I forgot to turn my speakers down, man. I could go in and turn
it down. I don't think they hear it, so it doesn't matter.
Yeah. But they set up two different feuds during that tag team match, if you didn't notice. One of the feuds is what we reported, Stardust and Goldust against A New Day, which is the
I hate the way that faction's name, because when you write, you can't put, and then the A New Day. You can't put the A New Day. So it's hard. You have to write around it.
You brought up a good point.
I'm going to turn that down while you talk.
All right, go ahead. Boo brought up a good point. We'll talk about it when you get back.
I always bring up good points.
Sometimes you bring up good points. But anyways, what I said is, okay, you've got Stardust and you've got Goldust. So there's two of them, and you've got three guys that are in the faction of A New Day. You've got Big E Langston, you've got Xavier Woods, and you've got Kofi Kingston. So as far as size is concerned, I had figured that you would have Goldust and Stardust.
Chop stone, by the way. 2 fucking seconds, in and out.
That was good. I was fucking around with
Internet,
man. I was fucking around with Internet Sports and everything else, man. But, so I had figured, as far as size is concerned, Stardust and Goldust, you know, what, about 200 pounds pop, right? Each of them 180.
Excuse me?
180, 200 pounds pop.
Goldust, big boy.
Yeah.
He's like tall. 6'8".
He is tall.
He's not chunky, but he's big. You know.
But anyways, so.
He's got to be 260, I would think.
I would take Stardust and Goldust and pair them up against Xavier Woods and Kofi Kingston. Big E's kind of the odd man out there. Now,
Big E and Goldust kind of match up. I mean, Biggie's obviously more muscular, but Goldust, the height difference makes it look okay.
So I had said they're going to do that. I think, you know, Biggie will be kind of on the outside
of the
ring.
I missed the
Biggie beginning. Would be on the outside of the ring. Well, we go back to Michael Hayes, which we'll talk about here in a minute. So it's 3-on-2. How are they going to do this feud, you know, when it should be 2-on-2 in a tag team match?
Did they do the paper, rock, scissors to the side? What did they do to this side? I remember there was something they did.
I don't remember, but they had, who was it? It was Big E and Kofi who worked the match against Stardust and Goldust, and Xavier Woods was on the outside of the ring last
night. And
Xavier
Woods, they all changed their look with the blue shit. And I think it was Big E had like a little scarf tucked in his singlet.
Right.
And halfway pulled out and like dabbed his sweat.
But
Xavier Woods doesn't have a big fucking afro anymore.
No, he looks like Kofi Kingston, man. He's got a ponytail like Kofi. But anyway, so that's what they did last night. Now, what you brought up last night is you thought that they were going to do like a Fabulous Freebirds type gimmick where it would
you
be,
don't know which
you
two,
know,
man.
You don't know which two guys are going to tag
in. Really don't know. Back in the day, the Fabulous Freebirds, who, I don't want to get it, it's complicated, kind of like saying alligators are kind of dinosaurs. It's complicated. You know what I mean?
Okay.
But I heard that joke on The Office once, so it was a good reference.
What's the difference between an alligator and a crocodile? I've never understood
that. I don't know. Is there one?
There is.
Okay.
There are two different species. One's an alligator, one's a crocodile. But I don't know.
I have no fucking clue. But, point being, back in the day, the Freebirds technically created music.
Okay.
And entrances and stuff.
Michael Hayes has got a new CD.
They say Sergeant Slaughter did too. But yeah, Michael Hayes has a new CD coming out.
It's on iTunes.
Probably atrocious.
Probably.
Yeah, you almost guarantee it will be. But. Although Bad Street USA for its time was a fucking badass song, right?
Yeah.
Bad Street.
They've got the whole lawsuit going on with that.
That's true.
But
yeah,
back in the day, the Freebirds were
it was two incarnations, kind of like DX, but in reverse because it started with three and then it became two instead of just HBK and Sean and then New Age Outlaws X Pro.
Mm-hmm.
It was Michael Hayes.
Mm-hmm.
Terry Gordy. Terry Bam Bam Gordy, the original Bam Bam before Bigelow.
Mm-hmm.
Terry Gordy. Buddy Roberts.
Okay.
Kind of like the Ric Flair. He'd bump around. He was the bump taker.
Okay.
Bam Bam Gordy was the big muscle guy. He was the enforcer like Arne Anderson and the Four Horsemen. Michael Hayes was clearly the leader of the group.
Right.
But their gimmick, in a sense, and it was much more complex than what I'm about to say. One of the parts of their gimmick was when they would be, let's say they're the tag champs. Any two of them could be the tag champs of the three. All three of them are the two tag team champions.
Right.
But you never knew which two.
Which guy was going to face.
If you had a title match, like, oh, we earned it, number one contender, we get to challenge the Freebirds for the titles.
Right.
You couldn't game plan, like, in training, you know. Because you didn't know which two they were going to put in the ring during the match. They could surprise you, and it could be Hayes and Roberts, or it could be Hayes and Gordy, or, you know.
You never knew.
And with the New Day,
it seems like they're doing that.
They did, because I remember writing it, but I don't remember what it was. I know it wasn't flipping a coin. I don't think they did rock, paper, scissors.
I don't remember.
But they did something to decide which two of the three would be in the match.
Right, right. And they're probably going to continue. I'm just glad that we're not seeing Big E out there, you know. And God forbid, this may be coming, but, you know. Oh, You gotta train and you gotta do this. Whoa! Remember that promo that he cut? God, man, a couple of months ago, right? The Big E promo.
Some of the future shit.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's right. Oh man, that was
very racist.
That was
good old boy folk back in the day. Black guy stigma. Yeah.
All right. So that's about it. So they set up that feud, and then they set up. I mean, the match.
So,
the number one contendership for the WWE Tag Team titles, you had the Usos wound up winning that match. They're going to face the Miz and Sandow. And then they had a segment. It was kind of weird because they showed Naomi backstage watching.
Well, they paid that off later, if you remember.
Now, Maryse, the interesting thing is Maryse came out and issued a tweet and kind of involved herself in this storyline. Now, there's been some talk about former divas returning to the company, one being Mick James, the other being Maryse.
Eve Torres, too.
And Eve Torres as well. So, is Maryse, is this the start of something with a Maryse return to WWE, kind of aligning herself with The Miz, who they're married in real life, and, you know, Naomi and Jimmy Uso, who we've seen on Total Divas.
Correct.
The son of a bitch, why?
No, I said, The Miz.
God, tell me about it, right? But Maryse basically came out and said, don't be jealous, you're ugly, I'm prettier than you.
Yeah.
It was kind of a tweet where I was like, Jesus, dude, she's kind of...
Was she working, or was she trying, like, being...
It involved the storyline.
Kind of like, remember when The Rock... When he made the surprise sermon with Rusev and Lana.
Right.
He said something to Layla, hey, mama, you're looking good or something. And then afterwards, she tweeted, of course I'm sexy, and I'm attractive, and I'm better than everyone else. So she was clearly in her character.
Yeah.
But she obviously also thinks, she, you know, knows she's a fucking piece of ass.
She basically, I mean, Maryse basically said that, you know, my man would never choose you, Naomi, when he's got me. I'm a hot-looking chick, you know what I mean? I'm much better-looking than you. I mean, give me a break. It's not even, you know, something like that. Yeah. Something along those lines of tweets. So,
who's fucking banging hot, though?
She is hot. Yeah. Both of them are. Cameron as well. Both of them. Cameron.
They're not a team anymore. So
they're the fucking
bad ones. Okay, I know what you mean.
Hey,
Cameron's way fucking hotter, but so Naomi's a piece of ass, too.
We'll see if Maryse does get involved in this. I would say no as of right now, but you never know.
But they paid it off later in the fact that they had Miz on commentary.
Yeah.
While Mizdow was working.
How good is Sandow?
So,
oh, God, dude.
That backstage segment where he's fucking...
Yeah. He's got the replica titles, too.
I called that, by the way, if you remember. I straight up said... Yeah. I picked him to win the match, win the titles, and then I said, they'll probably
have the
Miz wear both of them because he's the glory hog, and then Sandow run around with two little fake replicas.
And they did.
Exactly what they did. But they've got them on sale. Take a rocket scientist to see that coming.
They've got them on sale for WWE shopping.
It's a good gimmick to sell belts. I remember when I was a kid, I bought those fake belts.
Oh, yeah, everybody
does. I had a little Macho Man wrestling pillow, too, shaped like a person.
I think I beat him up on the trampoline. Have a belt. It may be a boxing or UFC.
My boxing
belt.
Did
he send you something like
it was
that?
Called the Internet Wrestling Champion or something.
That's Zack Ryder.
Oh, that's what it's on my belt. Or the Internet's Best Reporter or the Internet Wrestling
Larry
Champion.
Larry Goldberg.
Yeah, the guy that owned
Boxing.com
for a while.
I think I may have that.
He got a lot of my own shit.
I know.
My own computers.
DVDs, Seinfeld DVDs.
TVs, players,
and everything else.
Right? TV set,
I got all
my gloves, my old MMA gloves.
Yeah, your UFC gloves. But anyways, all right. So here we go.
That's my bed from about fucking 10 years ago in there too. Dude.
It may be. It may be, man. But anyways, so this is what we're gonna do. That's about it for Monday Night. I'm kind of
set up some other matches too, like Eric Rowan Big Show.
Eric Rowan Big Show.
They set that up. They set up a.
Is that the chairs match?
That's it's a. Yes, I think so.
Or is Ryback in a chair?
Ryback's the chair. Match.
Ryback's in the chair.
I think Show and Rome is just a match.
We've got the main event set.
The main event's got a stipulation, too. If Cena loses, he's no longer the number one contender to the title.
And by the way, you said last week on our audio show, and we were talking about it, and at the time, you said it's sleeting and snowing and everything else out there. Yeah, man, it's like ice clouds in your window. But you said last week, and you didn't know at the time, but as we were talking, it just kind of came to us that the authority is the anonymous general manager. And then last night on Raw, everything was pretty much heel, right? From the
as far as the anonymous jam, yeah.
Out there, huh?
Yeah. Jesus. Where were you on that one, Weatherman?
I told you it was snowing out earlier.
Did you?
Yes.
Oh, that's interesting.
But anyways, anytime.
Right now, I'm not even listening.
Anyways, you want to talk about the weather?
Uh-huh.
You do?
Uh-huh.
Awesome, man.
What?
So tonight, we're supposed to get about an inch of snow.
We ain't got time to waste on this bullshit weather.
Yeah, we do. We're trying to go to the commercial break, and then we're going to come back. We're going to spend 30 minutes on each podcast.
Okay. Okay. And we promised to go long tonight. You did.
We'll go 15, 20 minutes long. We fucked up at the beginning, but everything's fixed.
You could do the Vince McMahon thing from last night. I own this motherfucker now. We're going 10, 15 minutes extra.
I own this network.
Yeah.
This show.
WZR TV network.
I own WZR TV. Yeah. I own WZR.
These are his t-shirts that we're staring at. Wearing.
And we're going 10 to 15 minutes long tonight. So you can either stick with us or not stick with us.
Stick with your ass if you don't.
So anyway, we're only supposed to get about an inch or two tonight. Yeah. And then it's supposed to change to sleet and freezing rain and it's going to be an icy mix tomorrow morning. But also on Raw, so we've got TLC, the stipulation in the main event, and this is where I'm getting into the Raw general manager, is where they basically are saying, I mean, why would the Raw GM want to strip John Cena of an opportunity to defend the WWE title against
and they would interrupt Lesnar. They would interrupt any babyface and clearly it was a heel, whoever this anonymous GM is.
It's clearly a heel, and it's got to be Triple H and Stephanie, where eventually they come back as we get closer to WrestleMania.
I'll give it to you right now what it is.
As we come back closer to WrestleMania, and they basically say, even though we were, you know, not in power, we lost power, we were still in power this entire time because we were the anonymous general manager.
Some bullshit to explain how they became the anonymous GM, but here's the payoff. They make the revelation that they're the anonymous GM.
Yes.
The match is no longer Triple H versus The Rock, obviously. Mm-hmm. It's Vince McMahon versus the Authority for control of WWE, with Triple H representing the Authority in the match.
And Sting representing
Vince McMahon.
And that's where you
which
get
which is interesting if you think about it, because Sting has never, ever, the only guy to never, the only big name to never work for WWE is going to be the guy fighting for control.
For control of WWE. Over the company.
So it's kind of an interesting plot twist there.
And Rob Feinstein came out and says that everybody is saying right now that it looks almost definite, and of course things change all the time, but it looks almost definite that Triple H and Sting is going to headline WrestleMania. Now somebody said,
why not
Sting versus The Undertaker? That's what everybody wants to see, Sting versus The Undertaker. According to Rob Feinstein and a couple of other people,
Feinstein's been right about not only a lot of shit in the past.
He's been right, man.
Everybody knows he's RF Video and all that, right?
Back in the day, had the big scandal where he sexually assaulted a young
woman. But as far as breaking scoops, there was a bunch in particular and recently about Sting.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know how my boss always breaks Daniel Bryan stories?
Yeah.
There's got to be something going on there.
Right.
Just consuming. I don't know anything. He won't tell me.
Yeah.
But this guy, Feinstein, always breaks shit about Sting specifically. So he would probably know what he's talking about.
Yeah.
I mean, plus it's obvious. Obviously, with the stare down, Sting and Hunter, that's where they're going.
Right, right.
And Sting even hinted at a lot at the roster reveal for 2K15.
Right.
He was saying, when everybody's asking him if he could wrestle one match, would it be? And he would say, Taker, blah, 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 blah. And he's like, also, I've been thinking, be kind of cool to work with Triple H, too, but he would do an interviews, too.
He said that he would want to face either The Undertaker or Triple H. Yeah. With The Undertaker,
probably. Because WWE didn't know yet if Taker was.
Right.
So he was putting both out there.
With The Undertaker reportedly out and no longer going to rest. That makes sense. I think the way to do it is end the streak.
Listen, his streak's over. There's no fucking reason.
There's no reason to break.
And he gets beat up every year when he works. He works one match a year, and he fucks himself up every year.
WrestleMania season always comes around and kind of get that itch. You want to go out there in front of 80,000, 90,000 people, but we don't see Taker.
First time in 21 years, no Undertaker at WrestleMania.
I know. I know.
First time in 21 years.
Yeah, 21
or 22.
Or 20,
21 and 1. So.
21 or 20 and 1.
I'm the one behind the one in 21.
Yep, 21.
So it's 22 matches. That's 22 huh? years. That yeah. motherfucker, 22 out of 30 WrestleMania.
Now, we need to get into that because, yeah. all right, here's what we're going to do. We're going to skip the rapid fire tonight and we'll
Holy
do
Ray challenge.
We'll do. Right, Paul Heyman.
He can beat the one.
So we'll do 30 minutes of the Punk podcast. Okay. Talk about that. We'll do 30 minutes of the Austin McMahon podcast. We'll run that down. We're done with Raw from last night. We covered the high points and the low points. So we're going to take a quick commercial break. We'll come back. We'll do 30 minutes of each. I'll put the rapid fire up on my Facebook page, facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR, if we have time after the podcast, because we're probably going to get into pretty good debates here.
We're pretty much in agreement on a lot of this shit. But it's a lot of fun stuff to talk about. That's what we got to sure. And we got awesome. SmackDown spoilers coming in the second hour as well.
Absolutely, so. Absolutely. So, all right, so this is what we're going to do. I'll get the plugs out of the way. We're going to take a quick commercial break. We'll come back. We'll start with CM Punk, a podcast okay. from last Thursday on Thanksgiving.
All right.
Then continue into Vince McMahon, Steve Austin from last night.
There's a all lot right. to remember from both of them.
Yeah, so. I know. We're going to think about it during the
break. Rapid fire, ask. Make sure to get your questions in because we'll be doing rapid fire.
Tell them.
Hour number two.
How you can submit.
During this commercial fire. Right now, this is how you can submit. You can go to facebook.com/...
That's crazy.
Fuck, we just lagged again. Did you hear I said slash and then the audio crap. I'm joking. I pause. I'm slapping knees, folks.
Sleeping like a motherfucker.
Yeah. Sleep, motherfucker.
Sleep, motherfucker.
Eat, sleep, sleep. Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR. Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR. Get your questions, comments in for rapid fire. We'll answer them in hour number two in a rapid fire style fashion. Ask us anything you want to know, behind the scenes or just opinion based, about the Punk interview with Colt Cabana. The McMahon interview with Austin.
That's what we're talking about in hour number two.
Anything you want, but try it if you can think of questions about either the Punk or the Vince interview.
There you go. And that's what we're going to be doing. We'll try to get to as many as we can. Can't guarantee we're going to get to them all, but we'll take as many as we can. We're going to put that up. The official website of WZR TV Tuesdays is WZRonline.com. Yes. And our live chat room is on and in progress right now. WZRonline.com live WWE SmackDown spoilers.
You didn't set me up for a
WZRonline.com. WZRonline.com.
Motherfucking.com.
This time I should probably say slash chat.
Yeah, slash chat.
WZRonline.com/chat. Get in there, lots and lots of people in there, as always, tonight. All right, we are going to get out of here for 5 or 10 minutes. We'll come back on the flip side, and CM Punk podcast, the Vince McMahon podcast. Get out of here.
We'll be back.
You're listening to WZR TV Tuesday. Flip.
What are you doing?
Right back. We'll be back right after this.
Do you want me to switch the audio?
No, just keep it the way it is for right now, and then next week, we just need to figure out, there's some sort of input problem, and we haven't changed anything, but...
Hold on, real quick.
I know what the problem is, it's just that I need to get down
there.
Let us know if this... Okay. Yeah. Let us know if this sounds
if you
a
can
little
still
bit...
Hear us, this was fucked up earlier, so they might not even be able to hear us right now. So please let us know in the chat, and I'll send you back.
See, what are you doing? Just as I apologize, I come on here
because
and I
just
apologize.
Reminded me that we're coming through the fucking thing. So
we are. We are coming through. So the quality, the sound quality is
I don't see anything
a little
moving
bit
while we're talking right now. So that's not good.
A little bit off. Yeah,
keep talking. Well,
right.
That one is, but
just leave it. Leave it. We'll see what happens in the chat room.
Was it better before or after? Is the question.
It's probably going to be better now.
It should
that we,
be. Yeah. I mean, we're coming straight through the mic.
Now we're coming straight through the mic. Basically, the problem that we had is we had everything set up, everything was ready to go, but the music wasn't playing. See, so the only way to get the music to play was to set it up, and that microphone on the production computer picks us up. Normally, we only use that computer for production, and the microphone, we've got the microphone. But instead, we're not using this microphone that we normally have.
It's better now. But what's very, very troubling to me is none of these levels are moving when we're talking. Like, wait.
That's okay. That's fine.
It doesn't even move. Hello. Okay.
Yeah, it's going. All right. But anyway,
it's not moving here.
So we'll sound a little bit better here for our new world.
Better.
Okay. All right. So we'll work with that. But listen, our apologies again for the production issues, and then starting late tonight. Not only that, 10-15 minutes. You guys probably heard us on here going
so
back and forth.
Let's get into
like, what is going on? So, anyways, our apologies
for
that.
Right.
WZRonline.com, the official home of WZR TV Tuesdays. We are on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube as well. Go to Facebook.com/WZR Army. Go to YouTube.com/WZR Archive. WZRonline.com, top navigation bar, social media tab. It's got a drop-down menu. It's got all the links to Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. WZRonline.com, the official home of WZR TV Tuesdays. Our live chat room on and in progress tonight, WZRonline.com/chat, WZRonline.com/chat. Get in there, lots and lots of people, as always tonight. What did you just realize?
I just realized I'm Damian Mizdow. The whole time, for years.
Yes.
Or at least since we became part of the video. While you're sitting there doing the plugs, I'm over here going top navigation bar, scroll down.
You're Clark Boondow.
I'm doing mimicking what you're saying as you're saying it, and I've been doing that a lot longer than Mizdow's been around.
Clark Boondow.
Motherfuckers.
It's Clark Boondow.
Motherfuckers. That was one of Vince's comments, too, about he says, did you hear the podcast? He said, no. He said, I heard that there was a lot of swear words and profanity.
Let me tell you, Vince... 100%, no doubt about it. Listen to that CM.
He had somebody tell him. There's no way he sat there for 2 hours.
He sat there. He sat
You're
there
an idiot.
Was over the weekend.
You don't know Vince McMahon. When ECW was around, he did not know fucking jack shit about it. He wouldn't watch it.
Vince,
he didn't care. And he was paying them money. He was investing.
That podcast.
There may be a specific thing somebody played for him, like one part. There's no way he sat there for 2 hours and listened to that. What would happen is one of the stooges would come in and say, all right, he talked about the medical shit. He'll go point by point and say the stuff that
he... Did Triple H listen to it?
He might have.
Did Stephanie McMahon listen to it?
She might have. I don't know. I personally doubt all three of them would listen to the entire thing. I think one of the little jerk-off writers or producer people would listen to it and then relay all the notes. And then whatever the notes that they gave them... They would say, all right, well, give me the audio of this part where he says this thing that you just told me, because I want to hear what he says exactly, not just what you're telling me. But 2 hours is too long for any of those fuckers.
I'm going to do it like this. I got one better for you. Linda McMahon.
Get the fuck out of my face.
Linda McMahon,
okay.
She's cooking a big fat turkey dinner on Thursday, right? They're cooking a big fat turkey dinner, right? Linda's doing the cooking. She's got her apron on.
Yeah.
Vince is there, of course. You've got the kids over, you've got Stephanie, you've got Triple H, the son-in-law over. You've got Stephanie's kids. Shane, Shane's probably there.
Right.
The whole family gets
Japan
together.
Doing business.
Well, he may be in Japan. If that's the case, then he can't be home for the
Sure,
kids.
He can come home for holidays.
He can come home for holidays. But, so you've got Triple H, Stephanie, you've got Vince's grandkids, you know, Trips and Steph's
kids.
So, yeah. They sit down and they eat Thanksgiving dinner and Triple H says to Vince, gotta hear this podcast, man. CM Punk just came out and released a podcast. So during,
well, I'm sure
during
his text
Thanksgiving
blew up all
dinner
night, all day too. Like, during, what did you hear about the?
During Thanksgiving dinner, they're all sitting around the table. Instead of the Christmas music playing in the background, CM Punk's podcast is playing while they eat their Thanksgiving dinner.
They're a more traditional family than you give them credit. Okay.
I'm joking.
Here's what happened, by the way. Remember how I told you that word leaked, that the thing got recorded, that Punk recorded, and that's why they put it out when they did on Thanksgiving?
Right.
So obviously WWE got word that, okay, Punk did the shoot interview. It hasn't come out yet, but he recorded a fucking long shoot interview bashing everything about what happened.
Mm-hmm.
So Vince and them already knew that it was done. So
that
what they did was
out.
They
right.
assigned some little jerk-off employee,
mm-hmm.
your job is to listen to it, write down detailed notes, relay back to me anything that matters that was said in the thing.
Mm-hmm.
Once he told him all the stuff,
mm-hmm.
that's when he would say, all right, that part about the fucking where he's saying that we did ignored that he had staph infection, give me the audio on that whole chunk because I want to hear what he said exactly.
Will Vince.
That kind of stuff.
And maybe this
he didn't
is the
sit
question.
For 2 hours
maybe
and listen
this
to the
is
fucking
the question
interview.
That I should ask.
Yeah.
Let's say that Vince has a little bit of downtime, which he very rarely does,
never.
Creative and
yeah.
everything else. Will Vince McMahon ever sit down for 2 hours and listen to that podcast?
No.
Whether he's on his private jet and he's flying to no. the next location, he's got a 4-hour flight ahead of him. You're
he
telling
works
me,
when he's flying. He works when he's in the car.
You're telling me that Vince McMahon will never sit down,
not for the
whole
put
time. On a headset or listen, and he will not listen to the entire interview with CM Punk. No. Vince won't do it.
No.
I disagree.
To this day,
I
there's
disagree.
A billion things he hasn't even seen. If you remember, we would report about it during the Monday Night Wars.
Because he says he hasn't
no,
seen
no, no, no.
it? Or because
we were told,
really
if you remember, way back in the day, I'm talking 2000, 2001, like when we were first getting started.
Right.
Where both of our memories shaky because that's a long fucking time ago and we used to have problems and shit.
15 years ago.
Yeah. Alright, but it was reported that Vince... God, I just lost my train of thought again. Motherfucker.
I am.
I know, it's my fault. I didn't do it. You didn't.
That it was.
They would have people. That was their job. If something came out, like a story or something popular, like, for example, let's say this Punk thing happened in 1999 or 2000.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody, Vince would say, all right, he would tell his production team, make me a production package, kind of like a pay-per-view video package before a match.
Right.
That tells the whole story in a condensed version.
Right.
He would,
right.
If like, a story broke, this guy said this on an interview. He's, all right, we'll put together a condensed package of anything that I need to hear and make it as succinct, as possible.
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
that is what he would hear.
So that I can get the high points.
Yeah, I hear
the
anything that,
right.
that matters.
Right. Right.
You know,
right.
I don't hear them talking and joking about this fucking right. minor story from back in the day,
I disagree. I think that eventually, whether Vince, of course it didn't happen around the Thanksgiving dinner table. Give me a break.
Yeah.
I was clearly joking there. But if Vince is on the private WWE jet and he's flying to wherever, I think even though he can be working in the background, but that Punk podcast, he's going to hear the full 2 hours at some point. I think he's got to want to know. You don't think that Vince wants to kind of know
I'm sure
what
he, Punk I'm sure he does know. Anything that mattered, I'm sure he either heard or was told very detailed version of it.
Speaking of the Punk podcast,
yes.
it comes out
the Cabana podcast.
The Cabana podcast.
Art of Wrestling.
Yeah. It's
a great
comes
show,
out,
by the way. I love Colt.com.
It was very late Wednesday night because I remember I didn't put it up Wednesday night because I didn't know
did it come
how
out Wednesday night?
Fucking good it was. Right. I
it
saw
did.
It Wednesday night.
Oh, I didn't know that. I saw
and,
it Thursday night. Right?
Well, I didn't put it up. I started it, man, and I listened to the first 15 minutes of it, and it was all Colt Cabana, and they hadn't gotten to Punk. It was very late. It was like 2 o'clock in the morning. I cut it off. I didn't even get started on the Punk stuff. So the following
morning...
Well,
if you recall, the first version that came out was only an hour of it, and then we realized,
right.
there's like a whole another hour that we don't have, and then we quickly found that.
So I go
you
in.
You fucking shared it. You paid for everybody to download that fucking thing off your server.
I know.
How much money that's going to cost you, you dumb fuck?
No.
He's too good to you guys.
Wait a minute.
He's
too
so good to you guys.
Any images, you know what? Any images
you know,
like that you, you put up
me
the WrestlingAnswer.com.
Yeah. It cost me nothing. A 56 kilobyte image versus a fucking 2 gig file.
I get it. I know.
It's huge. And somebody downloading versus loading.
I go to get an image the other day. It was like a DVD cover. Right,
yeah.
And I go to copy image location.
Image URL,
right,
yeah.
I see the image URL is the WrestlingAnswer.com. I said this motherfucker has been using my server. this guy.
If I upload the WordPress, it resizes it and makes it weird, so I can't
Man.
Do that. So for specific sized images, I have to go to Photoshop, make them a certain
bitch.
Size that they don't fuck up the table
of
the post. You
right.
know what I mean?
Right.
Like the table body and stretch it out.
You gotta shrink it down.
So I gotta do it. But I can't shrink it because then it looks stretched or
something. Yeah, crop it on Photoshop.
Crop it, resize,
yeah.
then I gotta upload
yeah.
it to your
yeah.
server, then I gotta do a version for the article
Stay
on this site,
man.
A version for the
it's
article
on this site.
It's
a lot of stuff
it's
that we go
way
through,
more
man.
Complicated than you realize.
But anyways, but it comes down to bandwidth, and...
Yeah, you paid right. a lot for fucking people to hear that Punk interview.
Pay about $300-$400 a month
yeah.
for that server.
It's like loud.
Crazy out there, right? All right, so
let's get into
Thanksgiving, brother. Yes. So Colt Cabana comes out with this podcast. Yeah. And basically, they open it up. He has podcasts. Basically, every week. And they open it up, and the first words out of CM Punk's mouth are, I don't want this to be a shoot interview.
Yeah.
I don't want to sound like I'm coming out here and I'm trashing WWE. I don't want it to be a shoot interview.
He just wants to tell
the
story.
Let me define a shoot interview for you. A shoot interview is when you come out and whatever is on your mind, it was, say if you quit WWE, this was the shoot of all shoot interviews. CM Punk came out, and maybe
he
didn't intend for this to be a shoot. He didn't want to trash the company. He didn't want to
Here's
sound like, fuck WWE, I'm never going, it's
You're exactly right. Shoot interviews basically telling the truth. You're not kayfabing. Kayfabing means to work the audience.
To work and stay in
a
character.
Shoot means this is exactly the truth. That there's no bullshit. This is the reality of behind the scenes of what happened. He didn't want it to be a shoot interview because the shoot interviews that are popular, RF videos, the one main one, the other one's kayfabe commentary.
Are people trashing?
There is an agenda beforehand to sell the DVDs, the shoot interview DVDs.
Right.
We want you to fucking talk about this subject, these hot button issues.
Correct.
And we pretty much want you, they're pretty much hoping that they're going to say negative shit so that they can have flashy quotes to go
for
the cover,
right,
a flashy
right.
excerpt to put as your trailer on YouTube to try and plug the full thing.
Absolutely.
They didn't want it to be a thing where he's going out of his way just to talk about negative parts of his career there. Mm-hmm. All he wanted to do was start from a certain point
and then
come to the current day and time and just tell everything that happened. He wasn't like, let me just tell the negative parts. He was like, let me tell you everything that happened from here to here.
But everything was negative.
So that's what he meant.
Everything was negative.
Well,
that's
just how it turned out.
You just brought it up.
He said, Vince said, I owe you a favor. He said, there was stuff.
But a shoot interview is when somebody comes out and they just want to tell the truth. They want to speak
their mind. Shoot interview is where a guy gets fired, needs some money, and somebody pays him to fucking talk into a microphone.
Right, but they also want to speak the truth, and if it comes down to trashing the company, this CM Punk came out.
That's where they finally want to say what they're really thinking, but they've been holding in because they don't want to get in trouble in the company while they're working for them.
CM Punk came out and did exactly that.
Well, but his thing is, he never gave a shit even when he worked for the company.
Right.
So there's no difference, really. If he did an interview, he was telling you what he thought. He was always shooting.
He hadn't spoken until this point. I mean,
he fell off the face of the fucking planet.
There's been nothing on Twitter besides some hockey tweets.
But even like
there,
his friends said, even hockey tweets.
Yeah.
There was a solid 4 or 5 month period where he didn't post anything.
Nothing.
Hockey, nothing.
Nothing.
Nothing. So I remember the first time he posted a tweet, it became a story. Like, holy shit, Punk posted a tweet.
Right.
And it was like a nothing tweet. But, so he went dark that long, and then when he has spoken recently, it's either been on Talking Dead or talking about NHL.
And there's been nothing mentioned about WWE.
He won't talk to any of his old friends. Like, Jericho even put a video response out, kind of one of the points that Punk talked about, which we're going to get to in a second, but Jericho was like, he wouldn't even talk to me, and I tried texting him, not even about...
And they were good friends.
I'm sure they were decent friends.
Like, so, they start the interview where Punk's like, I don't even know where to start. You know, where do I even start?
He says I could go as far back as
and I don't even know where to start. He just basically said that what happened is what we had put up on the websites is it was a bunch of different things that had been happening. And eventually, he had been promised this and promised that and promised another thing. That's happens. It happens because it's the
it doesn't say we're disconnected.
It's the free version. It's the free. Okay. You only get it one of the
months. Let's go on the chat.
So things boiled over.
Yeah. He said there's been rumor. Why did I leave? But he said, well, there's been talk. There's talk that I didn't get the WrestleMania main event, and that's what I wanted. There's talk that I was sick of losing the part-time people. There's talk that I didn't, he listed each fucking thing that was rumored as why he quit.
What
he
said, all of
them? He said pretty much there's a little truth to all of them. And
right.
He said the one more than any of them was his health. His physical condition and the way it was ignored or handled, or not handled,
well,
in WWE. And that was the biggest and the most relevant and most important part of that entire 2-hour interview, even though it wasn't the most exciting or entertaining to listen to as a fan,
right,
as far as what the possible repercussions could be coming out of this whole thing, him saying that WWE's appointed medical staff would blatantly ignore when he would say, yo,
right,
I've got this issue here. Nah, you're all right. I took this drug test, and then you can't work until you're cleared, and then they clear him, and he's like, how can I be cleared? I haven't even fucking gone to the doctor yet.
Is he lying when he says, how many times, over and over and over again, have we seen talents go down with an injury, and they come back way sooner than they are supposed to come back? And what is the reason for
financially?
It's WWE saying, we need you back.
That is financial. You don't, if you're not on the road, you're not getting your house show payoffs. You're not getting your fucking pay-per-view payoffs. You're not getting, you know, your merchandise sales go down because you're not being seen.
Punk had claimed that he had a bubble, a welt on his back.
He said it was, the guy that worked for WWE told him it was just a fatty deposit.
A fatty deposit, but it was a kind of a welt on his back. The WWE doctor had said, like you said, it's growth, it's going to go away, it's not a big deal, let it go. Now, and real briefly, a photo came out of Kane just a week or two ago at Survivor Series.
Not a week or two. It was at Survivor Series. It just came
out. But the photo came out, you know, within the last week or so.
Or last week.
You know, and it's similar to what CM Punk was talking about.
It does, but I've seen staph infection firsthand. As far as what it does to you, like, I remember, it's a very famous picture. You Google, I guarantee you, my site comes up. I mean, he was like, Kevin Randleman. Remember him, the monster Kevin Randleman?
Absolutely.
The black Tito Ortiz with the blonde hair. He had a staph infection, like, right here.
Yeah.
And when he, and it was literally a gaping hole. And it looked like his fucking, like, there was a hole in his entire, it was the most disgusting thing you've ever seen. My grandma, who was my mother growing up, for real, and she was the one that raised me.
Right.
She had staph infection twice, and got both of her legs amputated. She has no legs.
Man.
She sits in a wheelchair with no legs. Because of staph infection. Now, what it is, like, as far as MMA...
And is it because she didn't get it treated? Is that why she had that?
It's not treated in time. You gotta cut that fucker off. Because basically what it's doing is eating away at your fucking body.
Right.
It's eating away at your life.
Absolutely.
So, a lot, like in MMA, it happens a lot because if you don't clean the mats enough...
Right.
You get enough dirt and stuff built up. Like, if you sleep on a dirty mat, you don't clean your sheets...
It's the same thing with HIV, right? If blood goes from...
Well, this
from,
doesn't even take blood. This is just, like, bacteria.
Right.
Fungus, things like that. Like, if you don't clean, like, if you sleep on the same mattress with the same sheets and you don't wash them for 10 years, you're going to probably more likely than not get that. As long as you shower every day, you're at least cleaning it off. But if you don't shower and you're getting all this crap, bad stuff.
Did your grandmother have to have her legs amputated because she didn't get it checked out? And I'm bringing this up for a reason.
It went too long to the point where their only choice was, there was no way to fix it other than to just
take her legs off.
If they didn't cut her legs off, it was going to continue to rot and eat the rest of her body.
So here's an example of how serious this could be. Boone's got a grandmother who didn't get her legs treated in time and eventually
cut them fuckers off.
Had to have her legs cut off. Yep. So WWE's doctor tells CM Punk...
The question is, did he know it was staph infection or you gotta think if he knew, he would not purposely not let the fucking guy know.
But he's the top star at the time. He's the WWE champion.
Doesn't matter. This is something. Staph infection is something serious enough. Especially if it's on your back. That can eat away at your kidneys. That could kill you. And I think Punk even said the doctor that told him when he finally said it. He said, there's a chance you could be dead right now.
And that's another thing. It was
life threatening what he had.
CM Punk went to another doctor. AJ Lee.
His wife. Patrick Bateman was the name of the doctor.
Patrick Bateman. Yeah. So he goes to Patrick Bateman, who's AJ Lee, his now wife, her doctor, and he basically says, like
he said, let me take a look at it. As soon as you saw it, he said, it didn't think, he said, that is staph infection.
You could be dead.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And of course, he eventually wound up getting it treated through him.
Yeah, they were talking about how he squeezed the thing and it was squirting everywhere.
And then there were times...
It was the most painful thing he's ever felt.
You know, there were times where, you know, there was a moving on a different subject that he talked about was, there was a movie, not the Marine,
12 Rounds 2.
And all of a sudden, you know, CM Punk's in talks with Triple H, and he's going to be a big part of this movie. CM Punk says, I'll get back to you, I'll let you know, because this could, eventually, when I'm done with WWE, this could potentially be something
that's why he wanted to do it. The reason he was considering doing it then, at that time, was because when he told him it was scheduled. He says, it's scheduled for this and this date. And he said, dude, that's the European tour.
Right.
I would gladly not go on, you know, I don't have to fly all over the fucking world and work on it, and I'm in hurting and pain and shit.
You know how brutal that tour is.
Yeah. Fuck yeah. They all talk about it all the time. Every year they bitch and complain about it, but they're also getting a lot of money, so they're like,
But
the traveling sucks.
Right.
So he's saying, Triple H is telling him, no, it's not the European tour, and Punk's like, dude, I've worked 30 European tours. That means you've worked like fucking 90. It's the same every year.
It happens every year after WrestleMania.
2 weeks before Thanksgiving and a week or two after WrestleMania. Same time every year.
Same time every
year. The date you just told me is the European tour. You want me to do it? Hey, I'm happy to take the European. You know I'm the champion. Fine.
Right.
But then he said, I got to let you know about something. I forget why. Long story short, he gets... The next day he reads on the internet. That's how he finds out.
Randy Orton
starring in number 12 rounds 2.
Right.
He says he texts Triple H and says, called over text and said, what the fuck, dude?
You couldn't
just tell me that, blah, blah, blah.
Not a phone call? Yeah. Nothing?
And by the way, we haven't even mentioned that the most fancy thing to come out of all this and what Vince directly apologized for.
Well, we can move on to a different subject. Okay.
The most fancy, grabby headline attaching. Like I said, the medical stuff,
right?
That's the most important. Like, he also said he suffered a concussion during the Royal Rumble. He called the doctor at ringside, and he said the ringside doctor said, what do you want me to do? And Punk said he laughed at him and said, you are fucking worthless. Get away from me. You
right,
know what I mean?
He talked
about Ryback purposely kicking him, breaking his ribs.
Said it took 20 years off his wrestling career.
Yeah, Ryback.
Right.
On the steroid guy and everything. Like, he really shot on Ryback hard.
No, this is not a shoot interview, man. Yeah. It's not a shoot.
You know what he means, though. He didn't want it to be a thing where he's going out of his way just to bash.
Right. When you're calling Ryback a steroid guy and you're blasting WWE's doctors.
He's being
honest. He's shooting like a motherfucker.
Clearly he's shooting,
So anyway.
But, alright, so he says that, like I said, that's the most important thing, all the medical shit.
Right.
Because that could really, if the mainstream media picks up, WWE ignores wrestlers who have fucking life-threatening things going on.
Absolutely.
If that goes out and spreads around, and the media that actually cares, not just the wrestling media, like the real media that matters.
CNN and people like that.
Yeah, not TMZ or us. Like you just said, MSNBC.
Well, TMZ is pretty credible these days.
Credible enough, but it's not something that everybody else will pick up just because it's on TMZ.
Oh, you'd be surprised.
No, it would depend on the story. They don't.
Right.
Not everything that goes on TMZ. Like, TMZ will cover Hulk Hogan returning it.
I'll tell you what.
That
anything
go on
anything
CNN.
Access, anything TMZ covers.
That's all the
following
gossip.
Day.
Yeah.
I see it on the Today Show.
Access
I see it on
Hollywood,
Access. But that's all the
guys. Yeah, those are the guys. I'm talking about mainstream
a lot of
news
CNN,
media.
CNN picks up a lot of TMZ stories.
On the website.
Yes.
But I'm talking about, like, if this became like a Benoit level or something like that, that's a whole different level.
Yeah,
we agree on that.
Absolutely.
If anything would come out of this interview that would be that level, it's the stuff we talked about with the medical shit.
It very well could be coming.
The most grabby headline reading thing, and the thing that Vince directly apologized for, was he did not walk out and quit WWE technically. He was fired on the day of his
wedding
with AJ Lee. The day he found out he was fired was he got a text or he got his papers or something. And
he got his papers.
Yeah, it was the day that he was getting married to AJ Lee.
And Vince last night, we'll get to this here.
It was
the
thing with Triple H
podcast.
But yeah, go ahead.
Vince said it was purely coincidental.
Bullshit.
And he apologized to him last night on the network. Purely coincidental.
The lawyers and talent side sometimes are insane. Coincidental.
Come on, Vince.
Yeah.
Vince, give me a break. When he said that last night, it was his wedding day. It was perfectly timed to get him upset.
It was Triple H saying, fuck you, motherfucker.
He walked out on WWE. Yeah. WWE's obviously pissed off. Their main guy walks out. What better way? And what vindictive way to get CM Punk than on his wedding day supposed to be one of the happiest days of his life.
It's supposed to be it, other than birth of a kid.
To give him his You're Fired paper.
A giant fuck you, nanny nanny boo boo motherfucker. How do you like
come
this?
Come on, give me a break. Yeah. But now this is, of course, this, I mean, listen, there are two sides to every story, but when I listened to that CM Punk podcast, and you know
tell
what?
Being honest.
There were a few different times. I mean, listen, 95% of that CM Punk podcast.
98%.
I believed everything that was coming out of his mouth. And you know why?
The 2% that you wouldn't believe or that you might not believe is him either not remembering shit right just because his memory's not great.
Right.
Or him kind of maybe not exaggerating so much as just only telling a part of the story instead of the whole story.
Instead of the whole story,
reasons,
yes.
You know what I mean?
And the reason that
basically, though, the 2% that you might not believe, he's not blatantly lying. It's just he's either not saying the whole thing or he's fucking, you know what I mean?
Reason I believe what he's saying is basically he's comparing the WWE locker room and what goes on there with the politics and everything
that
else.
That was a game by line.
You know, it's a high school atmosphere backstage where there was one that I mean CM Punk brought up that he sent out a tweet, okay, and he had the word shit in the tweet.
Because he shit himself.
And he shit himself in the ring.
In SmackDown, yeah.
And he puts it up on Twitter that he shit himself in the ring.
Yeah, SmackDown this week, guys. I thought it was
funny in WWE, and he gets a call from WWE, hey, you got to take that down because it's got a cuss word in it.
So you remember, but you know what?
You know what? No,
this poop ain't fun anymore, or something
poop,
like that.
This poop, right.
The double entendre.
But it's things like that, and it's little things like that. And I promise you guys hear about it time and time again. We put it up on the website. This guy's got backstage heat. Why? Because he went out and he said something in the media, or he bashed John Cena. He said, "Oh, I don't want to see John Cena versus Randy Orton for the 20th time." Nobody. It's little things like that where one wrong move, and you get punished.
Yeah.
You get kept off of pay-per-view.
Well,
you don't get your pay-per-view bonus. You get jobbed out on Raw. And you see it time and time again with these guys that get punished. It's such a high school politic drama.
Yeah, Vince said it last night. Austin straight up asked him, "God, why is this generation scared to reach for the brass ring? Why are they scared to go for it, this and that? They are afraid if they piss somebody off because WWE's the only game in town." And he did reference TNA very quickly, subtly, twice.
Very quickly, right.
Thing. But he says if you piss off, if they're afraid to do anything that will really go for it or break from script that they're giving and everything's over scripted, they're afraid to really do an attitude era kind of thing and go for it, because if they piss you off, there goes their career because there's nowhere else to work. WWE's it. What did Vince say in response to that?
He basically, was this the Cesaro thing?
No, what I just said.
No, he said that this generation is different than
Vince's
the millennial.
Vince's response was, well, don't piss anybody off.
Don't piss anybody off.
So you literally, what is it? If you're a talent, you work for WWE, and you hear that.
Right.
You hear, we want you to go for it. We want you to think outside the box. We want you to take chances and risks and this and that. But if you fucking take the wrong chance, and there's no way of knowing it's wrong until you do it and find out and get in trouble.
Right.
If you piss somebody off, you're fucked. So don't piss anybody off.
If you go out there and you do some...
So what do you do?
If you do some improv shit during your promo...
You go off script.
You go off script a little bit. Or you do something in the match that wasn't planned out
earlier. Or in an interview, you say something.
You got to think, I'm taking a 50-50 chance right now. Are they going to like this? Or are they not going to like this? And if they don't like it, you're fucked.
Yeah.
You're fucked. You're going to be punished. And that's the way it works. Wrestling is a game of politics. There's drama backstage. Yeah.
There's politics in any endeavor or business in life, but there is a fucking...
A whole lot more in WWE.
A fucking nuclear amount of politics.
A lot of times, you know, we'll put up...
Not wrestling. Sports entertainment.
Sports entertainment. And you're
very clear about
Vince
that, too.
But, you know, and that's the thing. You guys see, people see reports about backstage heat on this guy, and it's for the dumbest little things.
Yeah.
And I see comments.
And the comments are always like, "You're a fucking
retard. This can't be real.
They
do. Yes,
they do.
Time and time again, the littlest thing, man. If you
Punk would say it straight up in his interview.
Punk told you.
He said that there's never been a moment where I'm in a room with Triple H where he wouldn't look at me cross-eyed or fucking it was an uncomfortable vibe because I would say shit about him while he's standing right there. He didn't give a fuck, though. He had the balls to do it, and because it got over so big with the fans, WWE couldn't punish him for it because it was working so damn well that they had to let him go. That's how you do it. But let's say you're another talent, and you try and do the same thing.
It works.
If it doesn't get over with the fans, it becomes this massive thing.
Right.
Even though you're trying, and it's a great thing, if it doesn't immediately, boom, get over like Punk's pipe bomb or whatever.
Right.
If it doesn't get over... Even though it's creative outside the box, you take a chance. Call if it doesn't get over, you're fucked because you're going to get...
Absolutely.
You're going to get repercussions.
Absolutely. And it happens over and over and over in WWE. And that's the thing that you guys see these... And I think finally, hopefully, if you listen to that CM Punk podcast, and Boone and I just got done talking about it, 95-98% of what Punk said, we believe...
Yeah.
Is the truth because of the stories that you hear
time and time again.
A billion
things you left out. How about he found a royalty check in his fucking couch one day?
Right.
For it. Like he says, with some people won't even make it in their entire lifetime.
Right.
And he just found it laying around. He goes, but it expired, so he needed to get a new one resent, but he had already quit the company, walked out, or whatever the fuck.
Right.
He says, calls them, can you please resend it? They won't resend it to him.
Won't resend it.
And he says he says he was
something that he's earned.
And he said he was to the point where fuck it, I'm not gonna fucking fight over this. Blah, blah,
I'm not even gonna. It
was one of those that led into the. And then the next day during my wedding, I get my papers. Fuck you, you're fired. You know?
It's such.
As Vince, he said, texted him and said you're suspended for 2 months.
It's such
for refusing to be on the TV that day.
Right.
And he talked very detailed about the meeting the day him. Triple H and Vince were in the office, and they were telling him, WrestleMania, CM Punk versus Triple H, semi-main event, blah, 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 blah.
Right.
Punk says, no offense, Triple H, I'm looking you right in your eyes, I don't need to wrestle you.
Right.
You need to wrestle me, and I'm sick of fucking working with guys that are part... I work with The Undertaker, he beats me, and goes away.
Right.
I work with The Rock, he beats me, and the record-setting title rate of mine, he beats me, goes away.
Then it was going to be 500 and something days.
With Brock Lesnar, he beats me, he goes away. Yeah, no, he wanted to make it a triple threat with Batista, Orton, and him.
Right.
And it would be the 500th day of his thing. Or no, that was The Undertaker here.
Okay.
He wanted to be him. But anyways, and then there was the other thing where he said that he had come to the office with an idea where he wanted... There's two more things, and then we could bounce it.
No, we'll move on to the...
That's what I mean.
Bounce
to the next
we're going to... Oh, let me go
ahead.
Go ahead.
Okay, he wanted sponsors on his shorts. He said when he was repackaging his character with the pipe bombs, he came up with the idea, because he says anytime he changes character, he changes his hair, he changes his ring gear, he changes his look, he wants a whole different look.
Right.
Whole different feel, whole different vibe.
Mm-hmm.
He says when he did the pipe bomb, part of the thing he wanted to do is he wanted to wear like fighter shorts, like fighter UFC style shorts, and he wanted to have logos on them that were real. He wanted to go out and get sponsors that would pay him to put the logo on his shorts for matches on TV, just like UFC fighters do. Mm-hmm. And he said not only for himself, because he was trying to change it for the good for everybody. He said he wanted to make it
more real too.
Yeah, well, that and he wanted it. This would be a way for every guy on the roster, even though the jobbers who don't get as much money as yet, they could make all this extra money without doing anything. You guys don't have to do anything. Just let them fucking wear a logo on their tights, and that's it. We make all this extra money.
Right.
Vince says, we can't do that.
It's going to piss off the Raw sponsors.
Piss off the Raw sponsors, piss off this and that. And then he says, and then the next week, Brock Lesnar makes his return.
A couple of weeks, right.
Yeah. Well, he said the next week. But anyway, next week, Brock Lesnar comes in. Fucking guy, and he even said,
what does Brock have?
He said, the fucking guy, and he says, don't try and spin his dirt sheets because me and Brock are friends. He says, but the fucking guy walks in with fight shorts, fucking sponsors on him. He says, I went straight to Vince and said, motherfucker, that was my idea.
That was my idea. Yeah. Vince said to him, well, Brock already had these sponsors beforehand, and he was coming to our company.
Punk said he understood that too.
But they never went away. Yeah. I mean, Brock's still wearing the shorts. Yeah. When he comes back at the Royal Rumble, he's still going to have the sponsors.
That's his thing.
You know what I mean? So
nobody else gets to do it either.
That was Punk's idea.
Yeah. And then the second one.
If you believe Punk.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then the second one was, he said he had this great idea. He's friends with Chael Sonnen. And he says he gets it all worked out.
Another good one,
he gets it all. I was starting to remember things.
Yeah.
He gets it all worked out to where it's all set up. UFC event, Chael Sonnen, I forget who the fight was. It might have been Sonnen and Rashad Evans.
Big fight, then.
Big fight, either way. It might have been Sonnen, who did he choke? Shogun. It might have been that one. Okay. One or the other, it was a UFC on Fox, so they're going to be on main Fox.
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 Regular Fox.
Gentlemen.
Big
Fox.
Channel.
Prime time.
Fourth biggest channel behind the, you know, NBC, ABC, CBS.
Alright, so he's got it all set up, UFC agreed, everything's set, Sonnen wants it, this and that. He's going to walk with Sonnen to the cage.
What's the big deal?
They're in Chicago, his hometown. He's going to get all this recognition and this big pop.
Lots of media, WWE.
There's
going
to be CM Punk chance during a fucking live primetime UFC main event on Fox. WWE says, nah, we don't want you to do that.
Can't do it.
Because somebody might die in the cage.
And
did you hear that women are going to be fighting soon? And Punk's like, yeah, I heard that. It's going to be the biggest fucking thing of all time.
It's going to be
fucking
awesome.
Yeah.
It's going to be awesome.
The timeline's off a little bit there because women didn't debut until way after this.
Yeah, that could have been a case to see him. But
that's where his memory's not as great.
Right.
So that's one of the 2%. That's an example of one of the 2% to where his memory isn't perfect like nobody's is.
But it comes WWE says, no, you can't do it.
And then the flip side was,
what happens
1 week later?
What happens
1 week later?
A couple weeks later, 1 week later, whatever.
Out comes Triple H with Floyd Mayweather.
In a boxing ring, and Triple H is there.
He didn't mention, and it was
so
also...
wait a minute.
Also, Batista came out with Pacquiao.
Yeah.
But Batista didn't work at WWE at the time.
That's
maybe that didn't matter.
But
then Triple H was out with Mayweather, and that's fine. Why is he allowed to do it?
So why is Triple H...
Nobody's going to die in boxing. Nobody's ever died in UFC. There's people who've died in MMA. It finally happened. And a couple of people have died doing MMA. But, like, people you'd never hear of from a show you've never heard of in a little shit city you've never heard of, country you've probably never heard of.
Right.
Nobody's ever died in UFC, Strikeforce, Lyx, any of the main companies, Bellator. Boxing, the guys that have died in boxing...
Guys have gotten brain aneurysms after
you
the fight.
Name
segment.
It, bro.
Yeah.
Look at Muhammad Ali. They got a disease named after a guy because of boxing.
Right.
And these
right.
guys have died in the ring, live on TV, plenty of times in boxing. It's happened in football, too, for the fucking record. MMA, it's happened finally, but never in a company that you've heard of.
Right.
So the argument was, you ain't walking out with Sonnen because someone might die. With Triple H, you can walk out with Mayweather because boxing is more safe than MMA. Which, don't get me started. A boxing glove is not designed to protect someone's face. That's an MMA glove, so that doesn't help.
Well, I was going to compare it. What we got right here.
A boxing glove.
This right here is a real life MMA glove where they've got the thing, you know. I put it on.
It is your old glove.
You know, put it on.
What you talk about. I had two sets, by the way.
Yeah,
one had the red and the UFC logo.
Yeah, I've got those too.
Dude.
I've got those ones in there too, but I'll put this on. You continue to talk.
Alright, so a boxing glove is not designed to protect a fighter's face. People think they have these big padded gloves, so, because if you wore something like this, then you'd kill somebody. Or bare knuckle, you'd kill somebody.
This is where you get the eye pokes, by the way, with the fingers
jabbing
out.
Jab and your hands open. Which a boxing glove prevents because the thumbs are taped together on the back of the glove and you can't poke somebody with this, but you can...
When I do jabs too,
I flick it out like this.
See that?
The wrist flick.
Right.
My fingers are open. I don't close my hand and go like that with a jab.
Right.
I flip it out like that. So a finger would boop, accidentally poke you in the eye.
Boxing
glove is not designed to protect someone's face. It's designed to protect your hand because skulls are stronger than knuckles. If you hit somebody in the face and they hit this part of someone's head, your hand's broken. It's going to swell up and you ain't going to use that fucking hand for the rest of the fight. Although, guys. Like Arturo Gatti are famous for fighting through it. Mayweather's actually one of them, too.
Yeah.
Always had his hand problems. But, that's the point. Boxing is not safer than MMA just because it looks less violent.
Right.
MMA is way,
there's
way
a
more
lot
safer.
More death in boxing.
In boxing, they knock you to the point where you're unconscious, you're flat on your ass.
Right.
If you can get up before they count to 10, though, you're still not conscious, but you're able to stand, and you're like this.
Right.
As long as you can do this and keep your gloves up, if you're on Queer Street still, so you're going to go out there concussed.
Right.
And fucking damn near half unconscious, and somebody's going to beat the fuck out of your face more.
I know.
UFC, even though it looks more violent, you get knocked down, and they continue hitting you once you're knocked down. Oh, that's crazy.
Right.
How can you just let somebody hit somebody once they're knocked down?
Right.
Because guess what? 1, 2, 3 stops, all right, you're good. That's a lot safer for brain damage than, bam, daddy goes, he's up, and then boom, 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 and he hangs on and gets beaten the head on. Like Chuck Liddell had the famous quote where he said there's boxers who take 150 clean punches. They'll have stats, CompuBox.
Mm-hmm.
150 clean punches to the face in one fight. He said, I haven't been hit in my entire career in the face 150 times doing UFC.
Right.
And that means way more safe than boxing.
Listen, let's wrap up CM Punk's podcast.
I got a little passion about that.
You are passionate.
I love MMA.
You love boxing.
They had a big announcement today, which we don't have time for, but it's not that big.
Well, it ties in with the sponsorships where UFC announced basically today.
Oh, yeah.
With CM Punk, you know, with, we were talking about the
show. You don't want to start sponsors.
But basically what happens is Reebok is going to sponsor every fighter in the UFC.
Official uniform.
All of the fighters. UFC guys have official uniforms. It's going to be Reebok. Now, some of the main event guys who get paid big time money for
Nike or
they get paid big time money. They were like, "Well, what the fuck? We're gonna lose some money here." But the lower card guys
keep it still. Okay. Some of them, if they have existing deals, it's very.
For the lower card guys,
it's great for them.
This is awesome because
they might not get sponsors because nobody wants to pay.
Some of them don't have
Joe Jobber for the third prelim on UFC Fight Pass. Nobody's giving them money.
Now they've got Reebok.
Now you at least get this guaranteed money. And UFC says 100%
of
the money is going to the fighter.
I heard
they're
Dana
not
say
taking
that.
One penny.
I heard Dana say that.
They're not taking one penny. Yeah.
All right.
And
so
he says, as far as what the UFC, the financials of how much money is going to be dispersed to the fighter, he says financially this is up there with Fox in terms of the biggest money deal UFC has ever signed. And Fox was in the hundreds of millions for rights fees.
Right.
Television rights fees.
Right.
So this is a multi $100 million deal.
Wow.
And all of that $100 million
is going straight to the fighters.
Well, because Reebok gets a big cut too.
Right.
And they get their cut. But the other whatever percentage UFC gets out of it all gets spread out among the fighters. And they have a roster of 600, 800, whatever you have fighters.
Right, right.
So and it's different. If you're ranked if you're a champion, you get this much percentage. If you're ranked 1 through 5, you get this much percentage.
Okay.
6 through 10. This much percentage. If you're unranked, this much percentage.
Okay.
So there's levels.
So the CM Punk podcast, we can, I mean, I say 95, 98, you say 98, whatever, okay? I thought he was telling the truth. I thought he was being honest. And the reason I believe that is, like I said earlier, that stuff has been known for years. And I think that finally, when a top WWE talent, back in his heyday, which was just less than a year ago, comes out and says this, I think finally people start to believe that, you know what, a lot of the stuff that we've been reading on the dirt sheet websites is the real deal, where these petty politics and this drama and these games is played all the time. That brings us to the Vince McMahon Steve Austin podcast. Right off the bat, I will say this. Steve Austin was awesome last night.
He always is.
Vince McMahon didn't hold back, not nearly as much as I thought he did. Now, did he play it coy at times? Did he hold back? Was he corporate at times? Of course.
He was corporate.
But he wasn't.
He was corporate through the entire thing. But in a way,
but
where, if put it this way, if you're a casual viewer and you don't know anything about anything, it sounds like Vince McMahon is shooting, the word we used earlier. He's not.
This wasn't a shoot. Austin was shooting
this is
with
what
his
you call, yeah, this is what you call a mixed shoot.
Shoot.
Or a work shoot. Like, you know what I mean? Like a mixture of both. He's giving you
Vince
real
was
shit.
Politically correct.
Yeah, he's giving you real shit,
right,
but in a safe, padded, comfy, cozy way that nothing can
when he talked about Cesaro.
Saying.
When he talked about Cesaro and he said that something's missing, there was a little
bit
of
the only person that could, there are repercussions that could come from that is Cesaro could be upset and who they wouldn't give a fuck.
Right.
Anything that he says that could, like, oh, wait, media picks up on this, WWE's in trouble. The only person that the Cesaro stuff gets out that WWE would be in trouble with is Cesaro himself, and they could give a fuck.
And Vince's reply regarding Cesaro about not having it was
the exact point. No, that was not that big of a deal.
It's not that big of a deal, but that's the most
in fact,
that
if
I
I'm
thought.
Cesaro, I'm like, you know what, motherfuckers, you want me to show you some personality?
I'm
going to
show you something.
Here we go.
If given the opportunity, I'm going to show you something.
Yeah, but Rollins was the one that went on Twitter and said,
hey,
I'm going to grab that motherfucking Brad.
I'm
going to
Brad.
And you can
tell,
but he's the guy that's going to do it, too.
I thought,
Ambrose and Reigns.
Yeah,
and
absolutely. But I thought that as far as shoot is concerned, when Vince McMahon flat out last night said, Cesaro doesn't have it, that was the quote,
And he also said that something's missing with Cesaro.
Vince, maybe his verbal skills, maybe charisma. There's something I can't put my finger on.
That's where Vince was shooting. Now, everything else, I agree that he was politically correct in his answers. He played a lot of things coy. So, Austin,
well, even there, he's not really shooting because there's a comfortable padding there in that word. He didn't say, well, we actually haven't given the fucking guy that many opportunities to cut promos to see if he has verbal skills. And when was the last time you heard Cesaro speak?
Yeah, I know.
So if you're going to give the full shoot answer, he would have to say, well, maybe through time he'll get more opportunities, swings at the plate on the microphone, and we'll see if he's got a personality, as opposed to just saying, well, obviously he doesn't have great verbal skills. Well, how do you know if he hasn't cut a promo in fucking months? Well, how do you know if his verbal skills aren't any good?
Now, Austin starts out the promo, I mean, basically, you know, gets right into the mix, man, right from the... Austin is awesome. Okay,
he's a great fucking interviewer.
Awesome, man. And you listen to his podcast all the time.
Every week?
Dude, Austin, I mean, listen, a lot
that
of guys...
That fucker is like...
A lot of guys sitting in front, or right in front of Vince McMahon are going
to
hold...
Especially face-to-face.
They're going
to
hold
fuck
back.
Me, man.
They're going to hold back a little bit. They're going to be careful with the questions that they
ask.
They're
going to be nervous
and
intimidated.
Telling you, they're going to be nervous, intimidated. This is Vince McMahon. Austin came out last night. He referenced TNA, I think, two different times, very briefly. He mentioned TNA during the interview.
Yeah.
He says, let me ask you something, Vince. Want to talk about CM Punk?
Yeah. He says, yes or no question. You want to talk about CM Punk?
And Vince
said, good, to a point.
To a point. Yeah. And that's where Vince apologized.
I mean, they went to talk about for like 10 minutes.
They did. They did.
Talking around it about Austin's situation and bringing it back.
Vince basically said, I do want to apologize for one thing, and that is the walking papers on his wedding.
Yeah.
He said that it was purely coincidental. He said that there are times where guys get frustrated.
To add to it, not to interrupt, but he says, before he says it's a coincidence, he says, what happens is, there's different divisions in WWE. There's the legal department.
Mm-hmm.
There's the talent relations department. Sometimes they're not on sync
or
on
the same page. Right.
And he says, and because of that, it was unfortunately a very bad coincidence.
I
apologize sincerely for it.
Do not let me forget about the Savage thing.
Okay? I already forgot about that. I'm glad you did.
But
pressed him on that.
He basically said, and that was at the very
pressed
end.
Pressed him on the Taker one, too.
But basically, he had said that there are two sides to every story. He hoped that eventually CM Punk would calm down. Austin walked out back in his day. He had problems with Hogan back in his day.
Yeah,
they both said that they'd never
and
be back.
And they revealed during the Austin part, and this had never been said until, and I'll tell you right now, that it's like, that's in every documentary, I've read every book, and I've seen every shoot interview that anybody related to anything of that fucking walkout that Austin did. He never told us the part where Vince, when they finally agreed and Austin came back, it was never said in any media interview or book or anything or documentary that Vince says, you know, I got to fine you.
$650,000.
$650,000. I got to slap you on the wrist.
He said, are you
Austin's like, that ain't a slap on the wrist. That's cutting my whole fucking hand off, man. He says, Vince says, all right, well, what do you think's
what
fair?
What do you think's fair?
Austin said, he says, $250,000. And Vince said, all right, $250,000.
Now, Austin straight up asked him, he had said, if I had said $125,000, would you have fined me $100,000? Would you have gone with that?
Yeah, like, I don't remember.
Example of,
you said he shot through the whole thing, Vince did.
I thought Austin did. I thought Austin with his questions, they were complete.
Vince blatantly lied in a lot of parts. One of the main parts, there's two. The Jim Ross stuff, which I'm sure you're going to get into, but the other one was the very first question. Like you said, they got right into it. He said, all right, we've only got an hour, we don't have time to fucking have nice pleasantries, how you doing, this and that. Let's get right into it.
Mm-hmm.
We're on your network. How's your network doing?
Right. He did.
And Vince did fucking blatantly lie. The network's doing great.
The numbers
are awesome.
And blah, 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 blah.
And everyone knows the numbers are not great.
They're not good.
They're the furthest fucking thing from great in the world. And if you need proof, go check the stock price.
As far as
the rates, it's gone.
Absolutely. As far as the UK, he said that he admitted
there had been some issues,
but he expected that at the beginning of 2015, which is only a month from now, less than a month from now, he didn't want to promise anything.
Yeah.
He did say that. There's been some hang-ups or tie-ups or something like that. Here's the other things. Jim Ross, Taker, and Savage. Okay, we'll go one by one.
I'm sure there's something.
Unless you come
you're
up
talking,
with
go ahead,
something
I'll think
else.
About this stuff,
right? And we're going to try to get a rapid fire. I mean, come on, this has been a great second hour for you guys, right? We're running it down. I think it's pretty good right here, man. But we are going long for you because of the issues that we had in hour number one. Jim Ross. I thought the response to Jim Ross that Vince gave was...
We disagree on this one. I remember.
Listen. Vince's response was basically that at the
symposium,
2K14, this is about a year ago, Jim Ross was the moderator, the host, whatever you want to call him. He was up there on stage, and he had a panel of Ric Flair was up there, Paul Heyman, Daniel Bryan was up there, a couple of other guys were up there. And you could clearly tell that Ric Flair was drunk, and he was going off.
I mean, fucking wasted.
He was wasted, all right? And Jim Ross was kind of...
He made us look like CM Punk straight edge the way we are right now.
Jim Ross was trying to move on, and last night you brought up a point where Jim Ross says, I'm sorry, folks, but it looks like we're sponsored by...
Smirnoff, side note, in case you guys can't tell already, this event is brought to you by Smirnoff Vodka.
I thought that Jim Ross did his best, given... that Ric Flair was so shippy.
It's like you trying to deal with me interrupting you over and over again. At a certain point, you have to just give up. You know what?
This guy's
not going to shut up. Whatever. Let him finish his thing. And that's what Flair was doing. He would not fucking hand over that mic. For anybody. He would go on and on.
Jim did his best to try to quell that.
He kind of added to it at some points, but he did do his best to try and steer it back.
You guys know that WWE...
At a certain point, he threw his hands up and just kind of fucking let it go.
You guys know that WWE was pissed off. And by the way, 2K, they loved it.
They thought it was great.
They loved it.
So what happened was, Michelle Wilson, which is one of the high top
execs,
told Stephanie or something
she
like that.
She was in attendance.
So the way that it got told, by the time it went from her, Michelle Wilson's where it started, to Stephanie, and then ultimately
so
Vince.
JR wound up taking the blame.
Yeah, he gets in trouble for Flair being a fucking dickhead.
Right.
You know,
Flair's
on TV, he'll probably be in next week.
They wind up having a meeting, tonight. Maybe that's why they didn't mock Jim
Ross. And that was one of those...
Hey, maybe that's why they didn't mock Jim Ross in Tulsa last night, because...
Well, that was also... Just like you said, they had a meeting, and they agreed, to as far as the public is concerned, we're going to say we're mutually parting ways. But the motherfucker got fired.
Right.
Del Rio, they signed a non-disparagement thing, which Punk wouldn't sign.
That's where I'm going.
Okay.
CM Punk, back to the Punk podcast. Yeah. CM Punk did say that they wanted to reach, issue.
They wanted to release a joint statement, and they wanted him to sign a non-disparagement.
Wasn't asked.
Yeah, and he said, fuck you, I'm not doing it. Del Rio did. With that comes a fucking a nice chunk of change. They pay you off. Keep your fucking mouth.
So basically, don't shit.
Especially in Del Rio's case. Actually, Punk should have been, especially with all that medical stuff.
Yeah.
Maybe they weren't even aware of it. Who knows?
Right.
Blatantly, obviously, they knew what happened with Del Rio because that's why he got fired.
But Punk didn't want to do it. WWE wanted Punk to do it. Punk didn't want to do it. So that's.
But I don't think they offered Punk the amount of money, or even if they did.
Probably not.
That
with the lawyers and
with
everything.
Del Rio, they offered him a fucking sweet chunk of change to, hey, please don't fucking
not shit talk.
Because there's no way, even if they don't believe you, or if they question if you're telling the truth, no matter what, it's fucking terrible.
And does that not show you?
You tell the story of why he got fired.
For
those that don't know real quick, he got fired because he smacked somebody for being a fucking racist piece
of
shit.
Does that not show you
an executive, no less?
WWE is scared shitless of what goes on backstage in their company and what guys like CM Punk, Alberto Del Rio, and guys like that can come out and reveal about what goes on behind the scenes
in that
company. CM Punk did it, and Alberto Del Rio is obviously not going to do that.
He took the money.
He took the money, but Punk
said... Plus, he still wants to be in the business.
Punk's
out. He don't care.
Punk said it's
He's out of the bubble.
He said, life's not all about money, is what Punk said. But listen, so back to Jim Ross with Austin and...
Yeah,
and
so they agreed in the public, say, we're mutually parting ways,
right.
I'm retiring, this and that, but the motherfucker got fired. Towards the end of that comment where Austin and Vince were talking, this is where we disagree. What I took away from that whole Jim Ross segment of that interview is that he's going to be back before too long.
I got the impression that Vince was kind of, I mean, listen.
Vince
Jim,
said at the
Jim,
very end, the very last thing before they moved to a different topic, Vince says, there's a pretty good chance you're going to miss Jim Ross is going to be back.
He'll be back for network projects and DVDs and things
he's
like
already
that.
Doing that stuff.
He's not going to be back the full-time announcer.
He's already back. No. That's okay. Not what I mean. I mean behind the scenes. He'll be back.
Right.
And not taking over the talent relations thing because that's a full time thing. He wouldn't do that. But helping with creative, helping with the way he was doing it before he got fired. He wasn't a full time. He was doing NXT announcing when he got fired. He wasn't smart. Raw or SmackDown.
That Vince was still a little bit pissed off at Jim Ross, and there's always been a relationship between Vince and JR, which they've always gotten along.
Vince
but there's also this.
Vince hated the fact that he was Southern with the accent, that he was fat,
that
he was ugly, and he was the face of the company in terms of he's the voice of the company, and he's the face that is talking to you on TV every week, so why does he have to be a fucking fat guy with a fucked up face because of a disease and a fucking Southern accent talking about wrestling and this and that? He does not like any of that shit, but he's so goddamn good, and every wrestler loves him and demands that he call their match so much that... He had no choice but to fucking put up with
it. I got the impression that Vince and JR had this relationship where, they like each other, but Vince can't stand the fucking guy. he doesn't like him.
Put it this way.
Vince doesn't like him.
He respects the fuck out of him.
Right.
As far as his professional abilities.
Yes.
As a person, he's disgusted by him.
They don't like him.
He thinks he's fucking
doesn't look
trash.
Like his looks. He doesn't like,
the Southern thing.
Yeah. Anyway. All right. Yeah. The other thing is Jim Ross before Savage was
Savage.
The Undertaker. This was the listen. Austin straight up asked him, listen, why did you have Brock Lesnar, a guy that is not here full time, that potentially, and Austin said this, but a guy that potentially may wind up leaving the company, returning to UFC, why would you have a guy, a part-timer, like Brock Lesnar, come in and defeat The Undertaker streak? Now, my whole thing, and Austin didn't ask it, and I wish he would have, is why not a rookie? Why not a guy like Bray Wyatt? Why not a guy that's going to be here for the next 10 to 15 years?
You could tell
years?
He was trying to, and then Vince did what I just did to you.
Why not a guy
my point.
Between 10, who's going to be here for the next 10 to 15 years? Why Brock Lesnar, who first of all is a part-timer, number one. Second of all, is not going to be around, he's in his 30s, mid-30s.
And to stick with the Brock thing, Austin said, is there a chance, just asking you, why can't we see Brock on TV a little more often than we see him right now?
Right.
And Vince went on a thing where you don't want to see him more often. He's a special attraction. You build up to when he's there, this and that. But so Vince was like selling the fact, which is total bullshit. If Vince could have him on TV every week,
he would
take it. So that's an example again of where he's not shooting. He's not being honest.
He's
if he could have Brock on TV every week, he would fucking love it.
Absolutely.
But he can't, he's got to spin it when he's talking about it to the point where he wants people to believe that he believes that, we do it this way on purpose because we're doing it for a reason.
Right.
It makes it more important when he does show up.
No, that's BS.
Bullshit. That's because they can't fucking afford to have him show up every week.
That was BS. I don't agree with it. And not only that, but, Vince went on to say that he had a talk with Taker earlier in the day or whatever.
During the build-up to the show.
Okay, and Taker had agreed that, I'm going to lose and I'll put over. And Austin straight up said, come on, Vince, you're not telling me that Taker said.
Vince went into the big thing about why Lesnar was the guy, this and that, and then by the time he was done, he had said it in such a way where you believed that Taker was like, yes, if there's a guy in the roster that he that Brock's the guy that should
Brock's
beat
the
me.
Guy.
This and that. And when he was finally done, Austin called right. He said,
"Come on, Vince.
Come on, man. You're gonna sit there and stare. You're gonna look at me in the eyes right now and tell me that that was Taker's idea.
How good was Austin?
He was great,
how
man.
Good
he
was
great.
Austin?
Vince says, no, I'll own that. That was my decision. I mean, was it?
I don't agree with it. Daniel Bryan, yeah. Somebody like that should have been the guy to end the Undertaker streak. And then the last thing, and we'll get out of here. I'm sorry about the rapid fire questions tonight. We got to get SmackDown spoilers.
We can do a special audio maybe sometime, like Thursday or Friday, and just do rapid fire.
Maybe we can just do an audio, right? And we'll put the archive up, or I'll keep your rapid fire questions up. I won't delete them this week. And we can do it
but
maybe tomorrow.
You know, right now,
like
something breaking has already happened.
I know.
And those
know.
Questions won't be worth a shit because they want to talk about something else that's
right.
cooler and new. All
right, so the very last thing, and it's pretty brief.
It's a WCR curse, man. We have it.
It's pretty brief. Austin said, you know, and by the way, this was awesome, where Austin said, what do I got, about another 30, 60 seconds
he's
left?
He's telling Vince while Vince is answering a question. He's like, they're telling me we got 60 seconds and then we got to wrap this thing up here. I want to get one more thing off.
Vince
says, you know what? I own this network.
I own this network.
We'll do another 10 to 15 minutes.
I literally popped.
I wrote that in the column. I literally said, yeah, motherfucker!
I was hoping at the end where Austin's like, I got about 30
basically,
seconds.
Because I was ahead of him. He's in his room watching.
I'm thinking my
stream's a little ahead.
And then,
so anytime something cool happened, I would react real big so he would know something cool was coming.
You do it during Raw,
I know,
too, man. Because
he's on a candle box,
yeah,
and I'm not.
I know.
So I'm a little ahead. So when that happened, I popped real big so that he knew something cool was coming.
But basically, you know, I was hoping, you know, after they went to 15 minutes, Austin said I got about 30 seconds left. I'm hoping Vince says, I'll give you another 10 minutes, something like that. I wanted it to continue, and I think it's going to.
It did.
I think.
Yeah, they went an extra
No. They went the extra 10 to 15, and then it got down
to... I've got the on my computer right now. It's 71 minutes.
Right, but it got down to that last 10 or 15 minutes, and Austin said, all right, for real this time, I got about 30 seconds left.
Oh.
I was thinking, come on, Vince, 10 more minutes.
Five more minutes.
give me something. But I think they are going to do a part two, something like that.
They haven't talked about a part two. They've only said that
Austin
they recorded
more's coming.
Yeah, you're making it sound like they're going to get together and do this again.
Which no.
They absolutely
should.
We both talked about this earlier today. You brought up the great point that they should, if they're not doing Austin and Vince again, do Austin Triple H.
Yeah.
Austin
yeah.
Stephanie, and we talked earlier, maybe even Hayes, Patterson, blah, blah, blah. My thing is, it should be a quarterly thing. Once every 3 months, because that's, if
absolutely.
You get your people subscribing,
absolutely.
Can't do it every month. You got to let stuff build up to talk about.
Right.
But every 3 months. And it's a perfect hook to get people to sign up. If your subscription's expiring, make sure that the date that these interviews with Austin McMahon happen always happen the day or two after your subscription expires.
In the fourth quarter. You get Triple H in the first quarter of next year.
There you go.
You get Stephanie.
There you go.
And
annual thing.
And,
like pay-per-views.
I like
instead
it.
Instead of Royal Rumble
like
in
it.
January, you get Austin McMahon in January. Instead of Survivor Series in November, you
right.
get Austin Triple H in November.
Right.
Not instead, but like...
Right.
They do it the same way, that it's a regular occurrence with the same person, same time of year, every year.
One of Austin's last questions, and we'll end on this,
okay.
was, Vince, I want to ask you straight up, Macho
Real
Man.
Quick, too, also before Savage.
Go ahead.
Austin laid out a challenge to the entire roster.
Yeah.
He says, I'm looking at you right now. He says, I've been walking backstage, this different atmosphere, different vibe, and we talked about it earlier. That's where he said, Vince,
right.
the millennium people don't have as much motivation and ambition.
Right.
Austin says, he's challenging this roster to fucking
step up,
reach for the brass ring, which they kept talking about, and fucking go for it. And they also, Vince also brought the fact that, why is there so many goddamn writers? Now, in our era, there was two or three guys around your pool, they push in the pool, ha ha ha.
Did these guys, it's very easy for Austin to say, I'm challenging you to step up. Now, did these guys step up, and did they take chances? What if they take a chance?
We talked about that earlier.
What if they take a chance?
That's a decision you have to make. You have to say, in your head say, all right, I'm going to take this chance, but in my head, I know it's so fucking good.
I may lose my job over
but
this.
I'm getting there. I know it's so fucking good that I'm willing to risk it because it's so good that it's going to work. There's no way it ain't going to work.
Yeah.
And you have to decide in your head, am I fucking sure that this is the fucking right thing to do here? I'm
going to
take a chance.
Yeah.
I know it's risky, but I'm so fucking sure of what I'm doing.
Yeah.
That I'm going to take this chance because it's going to work. You have to decide in your head, is it worth it to risk my career.
Is it worth it?
To take this chance.
Yeah.
And that's where what you're saying is, Austin saying this, are these guys going to do it? Some will, and they'll pay the fucking price heavy for it.
Either good or bad.
Yeah. Right. No, I'm saying they'll pay the price, they might even get fired, whatever.
Right.
Some
right.
will, and it'll work. And then there's some guys who won't change a fucking thing because they're too goddamn scared. Right. And that is the right. majority category.
Yeah, absolutely.
Most people are going to fall in that third category where they're not going to change shit.
Yeah.
Because if you rock that boat, you might get thrown off.
You may get thrown off.
Yeah.
And the last thing, Austin basically, he straight up asked the Macho Man Randy Savage to the WWE.
Why is that all of
it? You guys know about all the rumors back in the day, and it's never been confirmed. Macho Man Randy Savage slept with Stephanie McMahon.
Underage.
Stephanie McMahon.
Yeah.
Vince's reply, and we can end on this, okay. was yes.
He said,
absolutely.
No, he said
absolutely.
He said, well, he didn't initially say that because that's when Austin pressed him. He said, there's a pretty good chance that you're going to. And Austin said, yes or no?
He said, yes.
And then even Austin he said, so I can take your word. You're giving me your word right now. Randy Savage, and then Vince said, maybe not this year,
but it'll happen.
It's gonna happen.
It'll happen.
Yeah.
So listen. The CM Punk
and why it wouldn't be this year when the Savage documentary came out makes no fucking sense whatsoever.
Yeah, I know.
Why wait? Now's the year to do it.
Listen, the CM Punk podcast.
Awesome.
The Vince McMahon
part 2
podcast.
Will be up this week. WZRonline.com.
I will give my answer first.
As soon as that podcast lands.
I think it's going to be Wednesday or Thursday. I'm not sure the day that Colt does his podcast, but I think it's Wednesday or Thursday. Maybe
Thanksgiving
Wednesday
was a Thursday, and that's what
came out. Came out Wednesday night.
So that was because they rushed it out.
Came out Wednesday night.
Yeah, Wednesday night, whatever. So they rushed it out. Maybe it's supposed to be Friday, Thursday, Friday. Who the fuck knows, but it's this week.
I'll give my answer first.
Go ahead.
You had CM Punk podcast.
Damn.
It is sleeping like crazy. CM Punk podcast last Thursday.
Oh,
last night.
Which one was better?
Vince McMahon
night. No.
The better podcast,
come on, man.
In my opinion, was the CM Punk podcast last Thursday on Thanksgiving. And the reason I say that is because everything CM Punk said, I truly believed.
Yeah.
Vince last night. Yeah. Here and there, and Oots brought up a couple times, he straight up, flat out, like, the network numbers are great. I gotta go see him.
I don't like answering this. I will answer this question.
Okay.
I'll just preface by saying, I'm gonna give you an answer in a second.
Okay.
I don't like answering this question because they are two completely different things.
Yeah, you're right.
They're not even the fucking same thing.
You're
it's
right.
not like which one was better because it's two different things.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
like saying which fucking game was better today, the NFL game or the NBA game. Sure. It's like, well, they're both great, but how do you mean which one was better? They're different sports.
You're right.
So they're two different things. Let me establish
that. Good analogy.
But.
Good analogy. I like that.
I like the Vince one better, and I'll tell you why.
Okay. All right.
10 years from now, you go back and listen to the CM Punk podcast.
Okay.
It was so topical of a year or two span of things that 10 years from now, it won't be as interesting because it's only about this two-year thing that happened. 10 years from now, you go back and listen to Vince Austin, they cover 50 years worth of shit. From when he took over to the Attitude Era, Randy Savage, Taker, Jim Ross getting fired, Punk thing, fucking, you know, the network, fucking the writers, and how it's overscripted these days, the roster's afraid. There's so much that was covered in that one that 10 years from now, you go back and rewatch both, the Vince and Austin one will hold up. Kind of like a good song. Like, some songs are great when you first hear because they're different, and then a year...
But wait a minute.
After a year, you hear it enough, you're like, that song's not as great as I thought. Or a movie, same thing.
But you're always going to remember...
Catching me off guard, but
a good
story's a good story 10 years from now.
10 years from now,
yeah.
I still remember Steve Austin's walkout from WWE.
Yeah.
Okay, I still remember that.
But that's my point.
That's CM Punk walked out on WWE.
And that's all you hear for 2 hours is Punk talking about his walkout.
I'm gonna not
the Vince thing,
forget that in 10 years.
Neither am I. But that's all you get from the Punk one is one story: him walking out, and here's how it happened. And it's a very detailed version of how it happened, but it's a 2-hour explanation of how he walked out. Austin's thing with Vince has exactly what we're talking about: a story about somebody walking out and this and that.
But you've also got Vince McMahon
with plenty other subjects into it.
You've also got Vince McMahon with his answers.
Yeah,
being.
There's enough in every answer. Let me add this before I forget, because I had these two things, and I knew I was going to forget one of them.
What do you got?
It's more rare.
Think in the chat room. Let us know. CM Punk or Austin podcast.
It's more rare to hear Vince
for that length of time,
yeah,
out of character in a shoot environment. Now, he's never going to fully shoot ever in his life. You'll never see it. Mm-hmm. That's as close as you're ever going to get. So it's that much more rare to see the Vince one at that length, at that detail, at that legitimate, real stuff. Mm. Punk, there's a million times in your life where you're going to hear him talk.
You know,
every time he speaks, he's being honest.
Listen. It's not leaps and bounds.
I said at the beginning, I don't like answering this question because they're both fucking rock star, legendary status.
CM
awesome.
Punk, Austin,
but this
McMahon,
one will be a little better.
Podcast, they were both amazing. Okay, they were awesome. Let's be honest here.
Let me ask you this question:
they were awesome.
Which one this week were you more entertained or interested in listening to or watch after you're done watching both this week? Which one made a bigger impression?
I knew the McMahon was coming, so they plugged it up, and I knew it was
going to pump up. Question. If you asked me, you've watched both.
We wanted to know Punk for months.
That's
not, and he hasn't spoken.
I'm adding to your point on this one, if you're listening.
If you
ask me a different question, if you don't say which one was better, if you say which one this week, when you hit stop on the network last night, and when you hit stop on the YouTube player on Thanksgiving, which one were you, when you were done, were you like, God damn.
Hey, listen, bitch. We
the one all. I said goddamn bigger on was the Punk one.
All
and
of
the Vince
us.
One was a huge goddamn. So that's
all
how
of
goddamn
us.
Punk was.
All of us have been waiting to hear from CM Punk.
Nobody more than me. I rewatch the promos with Triple H. His contract signing with Vince. His shit with Cena. His shit with Jericho. I just the other day I watched him and Jericho again. Just the other day.
Boy, you swerved that one up good, man. You swerved that. You covered your ass. You said, yo, I thought the Vince podcast was better.
I told
you
before internet. I didn't want to pick. I liked them both.
I thought
a lot.
The Vince podcast was better, but the CM Punk podcast,
CM Punk, more newsworthy and more instant gratification.
I love you, man.
Vince McMahon, it will be in time. That one you will appreciate more.
I don't know.
That's my answer. I said I didn't want to fucking answer it.
I'm going CM anything. Punk. I'm going CM Punk, and I'm going CM right. Punk 10 years from now.
Very
CM
fair.
Punk,
I can't
CM
argue
Punk,
with that. It was
CM
awesome.
Punk. You go.
It was
you
the
go,
best in the world.
You go. Yes. You go. McMahon, CM Punk, and yes, CM Punk.
Me? I go Vince McMahon.
He's CM
one.
Punk, yeah.
CM Punk 1A. Not one and then all two. Right. It's one and one A. It's a fucking tie.
We need to recount
the votes because the fucking 50-50%. Somebody's got to be the president. Is it Al Gore or is it George Bush? Who fucking won? Florida, you motherfucker.
A lot of people saying Def Punk. I'd watch Punks again at Vince's, but there's some Vince's in here. I've seen them up top too.
I'm not gonna fight for Vince's as the better one. I love them both.
They were awesome.
I'm not like I'm saying, dude. Obviously, Vince's is better.
And
I'm
these
saying,
people
I'm
right
saying,
here.
If you're forcing me, gun to my head, which one? And I don't want to. Please don't make me answer. I'm gonna shoot you if you don't answer. I love them both.
These people right here.
Yeah.
Except for the first 20-25 minutes of the show.
Jesus.
Ooh,
Daniel Humphries, please edit that shit out of the archive.
Help us out, bro.
Our show starts when he comes back in the room. Please.
You know what also starts? As soon as we go off the air here tonight, a fucking razor blade to its face.
Another thing that starts as soon as we get off the air.
In the shower.
At a website called WZRonline.com.
Live. WWE SmackDown spoilers. We're
going
to have them up on WZRonline.com.
You go over to that website.
I'm so good I know what this guy's thinking. That's how good I am.
Like-minded.
Anyways.
Yeah.
Hey.
Might not be a video show for too much longer.
Besides the first 25 minutes, I know.
Yeah,
right?
I remember that one.
We'll talk about that.
Chance, we might switch back to radio.
I'll still go video.
If I knew in my head, I thought about this the other day. I said, if I do move, this son of a bitch is still going to want to sit in front of a camera, and I'm going to have to be the douchebag that he's making faces while I'm talking, and I don't even know it. Yeah, I'll be sitting there talking, interrupting you like I'm doing now, and I can see what you're doing right now. I can look here, or I can look there, and I can see exactly what your reaction is. I interrupt you on telephone, and you're on the camera going, Jesus Christ.
I don't want to end on this, but listen, man. Boone's got some issues going down in
issues.
Florida,
yeah.
Florida, you know what I mean? But
opportunities. Yeah. Some opportunities down there. There's no Bad Blood. Come on, dude. If it was Bad Blood, I wouldn't be on here with this guy tonight. This guy's my brother, man. This guy's my
best friend right there.
Always will be. So, but we'll see what happens, man. Next couple of months, man, you may see me just here in the video, and Matty Boone will be calling.
Well, maybe the technology will be able to figure out a way to do it. Because remember, before I lived here, we wanted to do a split screen, and we were trying to figure it out, and somebody, I forget who, Dino UK, one of those guys, I'm
they
sorry.
They know how to do it.
Yeah,
they know
Morgan, one of those guys was trying to explain to us how to do it, and I was trying to learn it, but A, I didn't give a fuck enough, because I didn't care about the show really that much until we started doing it live here as a video show. You know, I'd skip. I'm not coming this week. I don't feel like it. If you don't pay me my money early, I'm not doing the show. You know, all right, here's your fucking money. Get your ass on the fucking phone, asshole. I'm like, all right, fine.
Okay. All right, but listen, we'll see what happens next
we got
couple of months.
Delicious dinner waiting right out
yes,
there. I can't wait
do.
To fucking
WWE SmackDown Spoilers coming up. WZROnline.com. Good show to the brother. All right, you are listening, or you were listening,
you are.
To WZR TV Tuesdays with Matt Boone and Ryan Clark. For we do want your feedback.
Yeah. We want your feedback for the reason that we want to know how to improve this show. You tell us what you like, we do more of it. You tell us what you don't like, we do less of it. This is how we make the show exactly what you want to see and hear each and every Tuesday motherfucking night. The way you tell us is by logging onto your little internet web browser. My Ryan Mizdell over here is helping me out. You go to Facebook.com/... Ryan Clark WZR, or you can go to Facebook.com/... Two fingers. Matt Boone, WZR. We're both going to put the post up. We both want to know what you thought. Facebook.com/RyanClarkWZR. Facebook.com/MattBooneWZR. You let us know, you some bitches. What do you want to hear on this show? We'll give it to you. Guaranteed.
Thanks for listening, guys. Sorry about the production issues in the first 20-25 minutes of the show. We will see you next Tuesday.
Tuesday. Give me a second, because I got to switch the audio settings.
WZROnline.com. Like I said, we're on Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube as well. Go to Facebook.com/WZRArmy. We are on YouTube as well. Go to YouTube.com/WZRArchive. Thanks to everybody that came out and watched that. We're going to have that bit. Started from the bottom, now the whole team fucking here. Started from the bottom, now we here. Started from the bottom, now the whole team here. Niggas started from the bottom, now we here. Started from the bottom, now my whole team here. Niggas started from the bottom.